Chapter 1 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Greg Giordano. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 1. Richard Barthelmess. Richard Barthelmess, in 3 years of hard work, reached the front rank of screen actors. The actor, Louis Calvert, states, "I've been on the stage for more than 40 years. I learn something new about my profession every day." The screen experience of Richard Barthelmess had covered less than 3 years when he put himself among the silent drama's leading actors of juvenile roles. His success as a young Chinaman in Broken Blossoms was his first big hit. Anyone who has seen the Griffith picture has added a new portrait to his collection of faces that are in the prologue of his book. Problems stamped indelibly upon his memory. The features of the celestial idealist as he leans against the sullen bricks in the gloomy and repellent Limehouse district of London, and broods upon the failure of his mission to the land of the Occidental, form a striking addition to that never-to-be-forgotten gallery of faces that collect in the mind at different times and remain fresh and untarnished throughout the years. Just how much such an effort owes to an actor's art, and how much to his personality, is not easy to determine. But young Mr. Barthelmess must have improved his time, since the day he quit Trinity College and applied to Nazimova for the part of one of the brothers in War Brides. Like the veteran of 40 years of active training, he must have learned something new about his profession every day. One Saturday afternoon, during the opening week of Broken Blossoms, the telephone on my desk rang, and a voice asked, "Are you going to be in for 15 minutes? I want you to meet Dick Barthelmess." "He's just the chap I want to have a chat with," I broke in. "Come right over before it starts to rain." 10 minutes later, young Mr. Barthelmess, accompanied by one of the most industrious publicity gleaners in the picture business, entered the office. "Tell me about yourself," I said, after the introduction was over. "Your rise has been so rapid, Mr. Barthelmess, that it will be interesting to learn if you have been lucky, or wise, or both." "When I became a member of the cast of War Brides in 1916, he explained, "I had no idea of making acting my life work. I was attending Trinity College at the time, and took this means, between my junior and senior year, of earning some money to help defray my expenses. Nazimova, who has been a splendid friend to both my mother and me, gave me the opportunity, and I intended at the finish of the engagement to return to college and develop into some sort of professional or businessman. But Herbert Brennan offered me a part in his next picture. I've acted ever since." "You are referring, of course, to the screen version of Lucretia Borgia, which Mr. Brennan produced under the title of The Eternal Sin. I don't wonder you accepted the part. Playing opposite Florence Reed is a position of honor in itself, and the records show that you held your own admirably as her leading man. My own recollection of your performance leads me to the conclusion that you were lucky to have been offered the part of Gennaro, and wise to have accepted it. You were regarded as a discovery at the time, and I remember asking, in company with many others, who is the boy?" "They are still asking the same question," Mr. Barthelmess said, smilingly. "Someone will have to tell the public I've grown up."
"Well, what's the hurry?" said the publicity man.
"Why not go on playing leading juveniles as long as you can look 'em? Why not star in 'em?" The actor shook his head. "I am in no hurry to see my name in electric lights," he remarked. "I think it is a great mistake to want to star before the public has made it clear it is ready to receive you. After all, it's the success you feel within yourself that counts. Some day I should like to be a director. After working under Mr. Griffith's direction, I guess everyone feels that way. For the present, I am content to be guided by his instruction." "What did you do next after your part in The Eternal Sin?" I asked. "I played one of the characters in a triangle picture called For Valor. Then followed a good role with Madge Kennedy in a Goldwyn picture, and several opportunities with Paramount." "You really have never had to go through any of that training which is always recommended as being such fine schooling for the beginner, playing what is known as bits." "No. I have been the loser by never doing anything but important parts, but I've been kept reasonably busy by them, and the excellent direction I have had was bound to make me improve and to enjoy my work. Doesn't it seem rather queer to sit out in front and watch yourself walk in on a scene? "Does it really seem to be you?" I inquired next. "At first it doesn't," agreed Mr. Barthelmess. "And it takes some time to get used to yourself. You look at the chap on the screen which the cast of characters says is you, and he's like an absolute stranger. After a while you get acquainted with yourself, as it were, the same as you do with the other members of the cast, and you cease to wonder why you are so entirely different in looks and actions from what you always imagined yourself to be." I picked up the copy of the Louis Calvert book which was lying on my desk, and read aloud the quotation that opens this article. "I have been on the stage for more than 40 years. I learn something new about my profession every day." "Do you believe that, Mr. Barthelmess?" I asked. The actor of 3 years' experience looked at me with the suggestion of the introspective glance that haunts the face of Shen Huan as he replied, "That is the one thing I have felt the most certain of ever since the day I started to learn how to act. And now Richard Barthelmess is a star." Tolerable David, his first stellar picture, gives him a character that takes careful heed of his youth, finely tempered nature, and aptitude for romantic roles. David Kinnaman, the hero of Joseph Hergesheimer's story of the Mountain Folk of Tennessee, is a barefooted youth, clad in a hickory shirt and torn trousers, but the very soul of romance looks out from his deep-set eyes, and his every action is animated by an eager and intense love of chivalry. His ambition to drive the coach which carries the United States mail is as lofty and disinterested as any desire to fight for a sacred cause which strengthened the heart of some valiant knight of the Round Table, and he battles just as bravely in defense of his trust when an attempt is made to steal the mail pouch which he carries. Richard Barthelmess is the most romantic figure on the screen today, by virtue of his innate refinement, compact figure, handsome head, and the exalted standard he has set for himself and for his art. End of Chapter 1. Recording by Greg Giordano, Newport Richey, Florida.
Chapter 2 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Matt Perard. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 2. Alice Brady says that she knows from experience the life of Riley is not for any screen stage star. No one is going to believe this story, but it happened just as it is set down here. I arrived at the door of Alice Brady's dressing room to find her colored maid gazing steadfastly at some object on the floor, a look of absolute terror in her eyes. "I have an appointment with Miss Brady," I began. The maid turned her gaze in my direction for an instant, then her eyes went back to the glittering heap on the rug in front of the dressing-room shelf. "Miss Brady has just gone to get her dinner," the woman said solemnly, and heaved a sigh. "You see that?" she asked, the fright in her voice echoing the fear in her face as she pointed to the dread object on the rug. I took one apprehensive glance and ceased to wonder at the woman's terror. On the floor lay a hand mirror, smashed into a thousand pieces. "She done it." The words came slowly from the lips of the maid, and she breathed hard as one in pain. "And she can calmly go out to dinner after breaking a mirror?" I almost gasped. "No one is going to believe this story, but..." "Sure she can." "But she's an actress," I exclaimed. "That don't make no difference with Miss Brady. She's allus smashing mirrors, but it don't spoil her appetite none. And it just about scares me half to death," added the maid. "Take a chair, please. Soon's I get over my misery, I'm going to sweep up the pieces." The handmaiden was in the middle of this task when Alice Brady returned, referring to the unlucky omen after her serving maid had left the room with the pieces of broken glass. The star of Forever After laughed a carefree laugh before she said, "I've done nothing but smash mirrors since I opened with this piece. and the last 2 years have been the most successful of my life. A remarkable young woman in more ways than one is Miss Alice Brady, stage star and screen queen at one and the same time, but in no way more remarkable than in her calm superiority to one of the sacred superstitions of a somewhat overcredulous profession. "Well," I began, "I've come to ask you the usual question when one is a leading light in the movies and also on the stage. How do you manage it?"
"To find time for both."
"Time and strength."
"Why, I don't seem to mind."
"But it's hard work, isn't it?"
"Oh, yes, but I'm used to that. I've worked hard ever since I first started to act.
You must, you know, if you're going to amount to anything. I haven't had a vacation in 2 years. Last summer, I rested by going to Nantucket and making pictures."
"Being the daughter of a prominent manager doesn't mean living the life of Riley, if said daughter has ambitions, I take it."
"No, it means living the life of Brady, and that means precious little time to idle away."
"It seems to be quite the thing this season for star actresses to double in the silent and the spoken drama."
The remark brought Miss Brady back to the topic of conversation that had drawn me to the borough of Brooklyn on a recent matinee day.
"Oh, yes," she agreed. "They're all doing it in our set. There's Elsie Ferguson making pictures and rehearsing in sacred and profane love. Constance Binney in Chicago appearing in erstwhile Susan and acting for the screen. And Dorothy Dalton playing Aphrodite up at the Century Theater when she isn't putting in the rest of her time movie acting for Paramount. Miss Dalton came to me when she was offered the Century engagement and asked my advice about earning two salaries at once."
"What did you tell her?"
"That she wouldn't find it easy, but to go ahead if she loved work and didn't mind a short allowance of sleep. Real art wants me to give all my time to the screen, but I am too fond of that personal contact between actor and audience which makes the stage so fascinating."
"But there is a fascination about screen acting also."
"Yes, indeed. For one thing, you can set out in front and watch yourself act after a picture is finished. It doesn't seem to be you, so you don't mind what you say about yourself."
Coming out of the theater, I was conscious of what a large part temperament plays in the success of an actress who ventures to divide her waking hours between the stage and the screen. Alice Brady had given a matinee that afternoon and would repeat the performance that night, and during an interview lasting over an hour, she had sat composedly in her chair, talked animatedly on every topic which arose, and given no indication of mental or physical strain. Living the life of Brady evidently means, for one thing, practicing the art of self-control. End of chapter 2.
Chapter 3 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Andrea Kotzer. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 3. Alice Calhoun discloses the secret of how to become a screen star at the early age of 17. How to become a moving picture star at 17 is a problem which is keeping an army of fat girls, thin girls, tall girls, short girls, pretty girls, and other girls not so pretty, wondering how the thing is done. That is, if the girls are within a certain age limit. If any of them are past 17, it is a question of becoming a moving picture star at any old age, but the younger, the better. Here is the way the youngest moving picture star in the United States, Alice Calhoun of Vitagraph, turned the trick. She started in at an early age to fit herself for the position she was to occupy in the screen world. In fact, she began her preparations before she was a day old by seeing to it that she was one of the prettiest babies that ever deserved first prize at a baby show. Realizing the flying start she had in the way of good looks, she insisted upon a daily and nightly regimen that should ensure the further development of this important aid to film fame. She even consulted her parents on the subject and admits that they gave her excellent advice and were of considerable help in selecting the proper clothing and dietary and in providing her with congenial home surroundings. Having been born when the moving picture was in its infancy, Miss Calhoun may be said to have grown up with it, if not in it, and to have kept pace with its development by taking advantage of every means of adding to her list of physical perfections. Her first decision as to a career did not comprehend the movies. At the age of 5, not having heard of the Silver Sheet and being the devoted admirer and faithful playmate of an elder brother, she turned her back upon her family of dolls and other feminine toys and concluded to become an electrician, after assisting young Master Calhoun in erecting a wireless telegraph station that would have worked beautifully if the chief electrician had provided any means of sending or receiving a message. This experience was not labor lost, however, but rather, as seed sown on good ground, it showed her a pleasant and profitable way of filling in the waits at the studio by learning all about the vitagraph wiring and lighting system, and then installing several handy electric effects in the Calhoun apartment on Riverside Drive. The evening I called there, Miss Calhoun evinced more pride in the improvements she had made in the family reading lights than in her rapid rise as a moving picture actress. Not at all a bad idea for a screen star to understand electrical engineering. Just think of the money Mary Pickford and Elsie Ferguson and Norma Talmadge might pick up between pictures, working in the studio as assistant electricians. "How old were you when you felt the movie urge?" I asked Miss Calhoun. 14, she replied. "And how old were you when you broke into the business?" I continued. 14, she again replied. Her tone was matter-of-fact, but her eyes showed that she enjoyed the humor of the remark. "Alice is very determined once she makes up her mind," said her mother. I studied the young girl sitting opposite me while Mrs. Calhoun told of the businesslike way adopted by her daughter to get into pictures. She won her parents' consent by proving that she was thoroughly in earnest and then went to a photographer of the best grade, had him make her a set of portraits, and induced him to show them to several persons interested in the production of photoplays. All this was working along the right line, but the deciding factor was the girl herself. Her portraits revealed a natural aptitude for dramatic expression, but it was the personality of Miss Calhoun, her ability to impersonate the type of American girl who reflects the best in cultured, clear-eyed, and physically perfect young womanhood, that opened the door for her into the land of her heart's desire. The eternal charm of youth is hers, and the beauty that is born of a steadfast nature and challenges the camera to search it with an uncompromising eye. "What was the name of your first picture?" I asked as the young star sorted over a pile of photographs in search of one that showed how a few touches of makeup transformed her into a woman of 26. "I started as an extra in How Could You, Carolyn," replied Miss Calhoun. "But my first big part was Mary Eastwood in The 13th Chair." "What followed?" "I co-starred with Charles Richmond in Everybody's Business."
"Did everybody in the company know your right age?"
"No, nobody did. I didn't tell anyone."
"It was nobody's business, as it were."
"How did you become a member of the Vitagraph Company?" "I began as an extra at Vitagraph, and then joined the stock company for 1 year. After my stock contract was up, Mr. A.C. Smith, president of the company, made me a star. He said that requests from fans and exhibitors and what he had seen of my work that had been cut out of the films were the cause of my promotion."
"How did you take the news?" I asked abruptly. "Were you very much upset?" so much so that I gave Mother a dreadful fright. When I came out of Mr. Smith's office, I was so happy that I couldn't do anything but cry. Poor Mother thought I had lost my job and started to console me, but I managed to make her understand that I hadn't gone crazy when I grabbed hold of her and began to dance. I thought that my other conferences with Mr. Smith were the most wonderful things that could ever happen, but when he looked at me calmly and asked if I wanted to sign a starring contract, I just couldn't believe my ears. It was a wonderful day also for Alice when she was told she was to become a member of the stock company, said Mrs. Calhoun. Yes, indeed, exclaimed her daughter. It was very disagreeable when I got up the next morning, cold and raining hard, and I had to be at the studio by 9:30. Mother said she hated to see me go, but I had never been so happy before over the thought of starting to work. I watched Alice from the window as she left the house, explained Mrs. Calhoun, and made up my mind that my pity was entirely wasted. The way she looked up and threw me a kiss told how happy she was. Nothing warms the heart like a signed and sealed contract. It's better than a sealskin coat, said I. Miss Calhoun found the photograph she wanted and handed it to me. I glanced at it and then compared it with the picture I had selected as being the girl herself. The contrast was startling. Alice Calhoun's ability to look a wide range of characters is remarkable. Let me see, I said, as I handed back the photograph. The name of your first star picture was Princess Jones, and a part of your royal raiment consisted of a gingham apron and a calico frock. Yes, the ex-daughter of a king replied. Gingham and calico were very popular at our court. Now for the most important question of all. What is the first rule of how to become a movie star at 17? Miss Calhoun thought a moment very seriously and then started to smile. I guess, said she, the best way is to commence on the right side of your 17th birthday. End of chapter 3. Recording by Andrea Kotzer.
Chapter 4 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Reading by Matt Perard. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 4. Helene Chadwick tells of moving picture making when the good ship started to buck. There are lucky mortals in this world who are always having things made easy for them. The heroine of the Goldwyn picture, based on a Ben Ames Williams sea story, is of this number. When she was a small girl and strangers were prompted to inquire into her personal history, the conversation ran something like this. Direct examination by stranger. Question 1. What is your name, my dear? Answer. Helene Chadwick, sir. Question 2. Where do you live? Answer. Chadwick. Question 3. Isn't that fine? Answer. Yes, sir, with great pride. Question 4. I don't mean that. Don't you see that when you learned your family name and the name of the place where you live, you had only to remember one word? Just think of the mental effort you saved. Answer. Doubtfully. Yes, sir. Sometimes the stranger varied the last remark by saying facetiously, Chadwick, eh? Did they name the town after you? And received this reply, delivered with much dignity. My grandfather named it after himself. He owns it. He built it all himself, and there's a street in it, and our house, and the trains go right past it. The Chadwicks of Chadwick are fairly well known in Chadwick, I take it, my dear. Yes, sir, we own the factory and the post office and everything. That's the way an amiable fate has always arranged matters for Helene.
Obstacles of all sorts have been removed from her path. When she decided she wanted to become a movie actress, she wasn't obliged to study the beauty hints in the fashion magazines, or lay in a stock of the wonder-working preparations advertised in the streetcars and theater programs, that are guaranteed to turn the plainest woman on earth into a vision of female loveliness overnight. Nature had attended to this matter for her. All that was necessary for Miss Chadwick was to walk into a studio and let her looks do the talking. She was engaged other Goldwyn pictures. I had not reviewed any of these pictures myself, but made bold to ask for an interview and was invited to call the next morning at Miss Chadwick's hotel at once, and because she had real acting ability, she made good. Last week, she sat in the seat of honor at a luncheon at Mr. Delmonico's Tavern on Fifth Avenue, New York, and was permitted to get close-ups of the very intelligent body of ladies and gentlemen who had said all the nice things about her acting in Dangerous Days, and, as the society reporter would phrase it, I was on hand at the appointed hour, and the interview proved to be a most enjoyable affair, especially so to an enterprising young miss of about 15 who followed Miss Chadwick into the writing-room, took a seat with an easy earshot, and drank in every word of the conversation while pretending to be reading a morning paper. I suspect that young person of a firm determination to break into the movies herself. Having learned as much of Miss Chadwick's personal history as is set down in the opening of this article, and sternly suppressed any desire to question her about her age, weight, or the name of her favorite author, actor, or director, I switched the conversation over to that safe and sensible subject, her latest picture. "What's the last part you played?" I asked. "The heroine in one of Ben Ames Williams' sea stories," was the reply. "The picture hasn't been named, but it has a splendid plot, and my part is the strongest one I have ever acted. John Bowers plays opposite me, and Russell Simpson is in the cast." A sea story. I recalled Ben Ames Williams' ability to put real men and women into his tales and make them fight their way through lives that are surcharged with real drama. Then I looked at the perfectly gowned young woman with the calm eyes and pleasant air of refinement and self-reliance who had spoken. "I'll venture that the girl you portray in the picture leads a slightly different existence to that which falls to the lot of most folks up in Chadwick," I said. "You're right, if you mean more exciting," answered Miss Chadwick. "The storm scenes aboard ship are wonderfully realistic. But, oh dear, what hard work it was getting them! Photographing a genuine storm from the deck of a tossing and pitching ship by a camera crew that hadn't been afloat long enough to know the meaning of the term sea legs was a heartbreaking experience." "I should have thought," said I, "the cold storage plant beneath that organ would have been the seat of the real discomfort." Further questioning proved that I was again in the right. "But the camera crew's devotion to duty," declared Miss Chadwick, "was a beautiful thing to see. Pale and woebegone, their poor wobbly legs unable to support them, the photographer and his assistant would grind away until nature could no longer keep up the fight, and down they would go on the deck. Reginald Barker is one of the kindest-hearted men in the world. He'd wait patiently until the chief cameraman made an effort to get up, and would then help him to his feet. 'I know just how you feel, old man,' he would say, 'but let's get one more shot before we all topple over.'" "How about the actors? Weren't there any good sailors among them?" "Oh, yes, quite a number, but I didn't belong to their set." "Did you suffer horribly?" Yes, but you know there isn't anything a movie actress will not give up for the sake of her art. Miss Chadwick hadn't been at all serious while relating the discomforts of the deep when applied to moving picture making, and I was not surprised when she paused to laugh before continuing. One of the male actors was a cowboy, a real one from Texas, who became a movie actor just because he admires Will Rogers and wanted to be near him. You should have heard what he had to say about the glories of the ocean when our good ship started to buck. I suppose he knew more about riding a bronco than he did about riding the waves. He had never stepped onto the deck of a ship before, and was a tenderfoot, brand A, when he listened to the voice of the tempter and signed up for that voyage. My, my, how sick the cowboy was, and how mad he got. What made him angry? Because the ocean wouldn't fight fair. Consarn this derned old tub and the way she bucks. I could ride her all right if this measly water under her would only hold still, was his complaint the first time he found he couldn't keep his feet. End of chapter 4.
Chapter 5 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Greg Giordano. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 5. Douglas Fairbanks. Douglas Fairbanks on Booth and Chaplin in The Crime of Dodging a Human Catapult. A suave and alert private secretary did the honors and ushered the long row of interviewers, special writers, and photographers into the suite of rooms at the Ritz occupied by the popular screen actor, Mr. Douglas Fairbanks. The sound of a lilting tune, whistled right merrily, came from the handsomely appointed sitting room at the end of the hall. Everyone crowded to the door. The sight which met the gaze was one that might have been anticipated from the well-known devotion of the movie star to the most strenuous forms of physical exercise. Clad in a gray, checked business suit, soft collar, and dark blue tie, Doug stood on one foot in the center of an imported rug, nonchalantly swinging an elderly Japanese valet, Indian club fashion, about his head with one hand. His grasp upon the brown-skinned servant's ankle was gently reassuring, and he smiled pleasantly at the son of Nippon every time the bald spot on the man's head brushed against the ceiling. "Mr. Fairbanks at his morning exercise," announced his private secretary. "Howdy, folks," called out the athletic star, as he tossed the valet over from his right to his left hand and reversed the man's motion through space. "Sit down and make yourselves at home. I'll have this almond-eyed servitor pass the cigars as soon as I'm done with him. How long have we been at it, Sakio?" The whirling Japanese consulted his wristwatch and answered gravely, 47 minutes, most honorable Mr. Fairbanks." "Good. Only an hour and 13 minutes more." And resuming his cheery whistle, the great exponent of pep and the active life accelerated the tempo of his muscular symphony and sent the human dumbbell circling through the atmosphere in even more intricate and bewildering curves. "Does Mr. Fairbanks always employ Japanese valets?" asked a lady interviewer. "Always," explained the truthful P.S. "Sakio was top mount with a troop of acrobats in Tokyo for over 20 years. No other training could stand the strain." "There is one fact connected with the scene just described that will not meet the approval of a portion of the Fairbanks admirers. It never happened. No one will deny that would have been interesting, if true. And it would not have been surprising if any Fairbanks fan had anticipated such a method of calisthenics, judging from many of the star's feats before the camera. Truth also obliges the prosaic statement that the number of scribes present was limited to one. Also, the Douglas Fairbanks was interrupted in a business discussion with his brother, John Fairbanks, and that the actor sat quietly in a chair throughout the interview and talked soberly of the serious side of the screen. Like all persons who have any real understanding of the art of the silent stage, The man, his reputation has been built up by his ability to do stunts, believes that the moving picture has a marvelous future, but that it has progressed but a short way toward ultimate classification of form and perfection in producing its several modes of activity. Whether the newsreel as a rival to the daily press, the educational feature, or screen fiction in its different forms, will eventually take the lead, he does not pretend to say. But he is very positive that all three will make great strides forward during the years to come. To the question, what producer has shown the most originality and freedom from the conventions of the stage, came this unconventional answer, Charlie Chaplin. Pausing to note the effect of his reply, and to smile at the questioner, the champion of the creator of Shoulder Arms, proceeded to state the reasons for his belief. I consider Charlie Chaplin to be far in advance of every producer of the moving picture. He is so sure in his effects, so clean-cut, and drives so straight at the point to be made. Now that he is his own producer, and relies solely on his own inventive powers and skill, he is giving the screen a series of comedies that are thought out and executed with an originality and grasp of the artistic that put him in a class by himself. A magazine article by him shows the study and care he gives to everything he does, and what serious business making people laugh really is. Chaplin's method of acting, said I, recalls that of the American comedian John Sleeper Clark, whose professional career was confined almost exclusively to London and the English stage. Chaplin never saw him act. The American died about 30 years ago, but Clark, who was famous as Bob Acres, Dr. Pangloss, and in a line of similar parts, made his points by the same thorough mental preparation and strict attention to artistic concentration that are used by the screen comedian. And now about your own affairs, Mr. Fairbanks. Do you mind confessing how you came to be an actor?
Early influence had a lot to do with it.
And of course, I started off with the expectation of becoming a tragedian. Why, of course. When I was a boy, Edwin Booth used to visit my father's home in Denver, and the magnetism of that wonderful actor made me feel that I must be like him and gain fame and fortune by playing Hamlet and King Lear. Do you still cherish the same ambition? Hardly. My first season on the stage taught me that mine was a case of vaulting ambition that had badly overleaped itself. Well, perhaps not. You are now firmly established in romantic roles on the screen. By the way, did you enjoy acting D'Artagnan?
Every minute of him.
How about the members of your company, the gentlemen who crossed swords with you or were knocked down several hundred times at rehearsals? Did they proudly exhibit their bumps and bruises and wait impatiently for the next day's battle to begin? Mr. Fairbanks shook his head.
Not all of them, he replied.
The principals were always ready and eager for a fight, but some of the minor people tried dodging until they found out that nothing but stand up and take it would fill the bill. You will admit that dodging a human catapult was a perfectly natural thing for them to do.
Yes,
but it spoiled the scene, and there was nothing in their contracts about standing from under when the business of the scene read, here D'Artagnan knocks down one of Richelieu's guards and pins another to the wall with the point of his sword. Realistic romance is what the public want on the screen, concluded Douglas, D'Artagnan, Fairbanks. That's what you give 'em in The Three Musketeers, said I. End of Chapter 5. Recording by Greg Giordano, Newport Richey, Florida.
Chapter 6 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Andrea Kotzer. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 6. Geraldine Farrar's story of how she learned to ride and shoot in record-breaking time. Within the next year, a three-day celebration will take place in the sparsely populated but intensely alive town of Cody, Wyoming. In the vernacular of the region, this celebration will eclipse any other social affair that has ever been pulled off by the united efforts of every man, woman, and child in the community. The scene of the doings will be the largest hall in town, and Buck, Curly, and other less celebrated cowpunchers of Cody will be the guests of honor.
Ordinary citizens and their wives and sweethearts will push and jam into the hall and divide their attention and admiring glances between a moving picture and a line of proud and happy cow nurses on the front row of seats. The name of the picture will be The Hellcat, and comments of an intimate and deadly sarcastic nature will be exchanged by the gentlemen in shirts of brilliant hue and sheepskin breeches, as one or more of their number is flashed on the screen before the deeply gratified gaze of the rest of the spectators. For a trio of days and nights, the roll of the bones and the cry of the crapshooter will give place to a prolonged movie jag and the delights of letting one's best friend know what an unhandsome, slab-sided critter he is anyhow. For the first time in its history, Cody and its bevy of cowpunchers have assisted in the making of a moving picture. The Goldwyn photoplay, The Hellcat, in which Geraldine Farrar gives her first portrayal of a girl of the ranch, is the picture, and curiosity is bound to rise to the all-consuming point when the Cody actors in the Willard Mack story see themselves reflected on the screen. To Geraldine Farrar, the recalling of her experience while the Western scenes were in the making is a matter of keen enjoyment. The novelty of her surroundings, the odd and refreshing character of Wyoming's native sons, and the knowledge that she must learn to mount, ride, and shoot in the shortest possible time, and before an acutely critical and embarrassingly frank body of onlookers, all served to spur her on to do her best. This state of mind, by the way, is the one in which Geraldine Farrar approaches everything she attempts. It is only necessary to listen to her for a few moments and feel the enthusiasm that colors each word to understand her success in life. Her artistic instinct responds to every form of dramatic expression, either behind the footlights or on the screen. The occupation of the moment absorbs her entirely, and she was as anxious to win the approbation of those unpolished but discerning Codyites as to earn the applause of a Monday night audience at the Metropolitan Opera House. Curly was a wonderful teacher and a perfect squire of dames, although he probably would resent the title with the aid of his six-shooter. Miss Farrar was sitting on a cretonne-covered divan in her Central Park West apartment as she laughed heartily at the recollection of her riding teacher and his engaging peculiarities. I knew absolutely nothing of the three arts of which Curly was master, but he taught me to mount, ride, and shoot Western fashion by a method that meant quick results or sudden and serious disability. No sympathy is wasted on the unfortunate tenderfoot who cannot ride a horse or handle a colt Wyoming style. There is no excuse for not knowing how. Such things should come naturally while one is young, like the whooping cough and the measles. So the male beings stand around and wait cheerfully for you to fall off your mount and break your neck, or pump a few bullets into a luckless bystander. It's the normal result of neglecting one's early duties in life. Did you disappoint the populace, Miss Farrar? I just had to. Our time was limited, and I was forced to do credit to Curly's teaching without the usual pauses for repairs. That blessed cowboy. I think that he and the rest of the cattlemen were willing to be known as my friends, but none of them could quite reconcile himself to the part I was playing. The girl is the daughter of a sheep raiser, and her father is engaged in a feud with cattlemen. Curly and his companions hold all sheep raisers in the deep contempt felt by every honest cowpuncher. I can't just see, ma'am, how you can fetch yourself to act out a sheep raiser's girl, he said to me one day. Them fellows ain't men no how, just white-livered coyotes, same's their sheep. They ain't got no rights on the grazing lands. When we wants to get rid of 'em, we drive a steer into the middle of their flock and tell the owner to get off our land. If he don't move fast enough, we hurry him out of the country with a gun and kill off his sheep. You oughter have a cattleman for your dad. Curly was a diamond in the rough in most things, but he considered sheep and sheepmen worse than unnecessary. Did you stay in Cody the entire 5 weeks you were away? Oh, no. We rode 50 miles up into the mountains to a place called Valley Ranch on the South Fork. Part of the road was so narrow that it didn't steady my nerves perceptibly when I was told that a horse and rider had slipped off the trail recently just at the particular spot where we were and rolled down about 800 feet. It was Buck who gave me the pleasant information, and when I asked what happened to them, he looked me straight in the eye without a smile and replied that he and his companions tied several ropes together and pulled the horse and rider up again. Every tenderfoot is fair game for their tall tales, you know. You must have found it comparatively easy to get into the spirit of your part in such an atmosphere. I did. The character is more like Carmen than any other part I have ever played. She has the same quick temper and imperious nature, but is good and lovable. In order to find an excuse for her black hair and the touch of romance in her appearance, the author has given her an Irish father and a Spanish mother. The picture has all the color and action of a typical Western drama, but we have tried to dispense with extravagant detail. My scenes with Thomas Sanchi are strong and fine. He's the villain, and he is superb. I've seen one of the prints run off. Those Wyoming mountains are full of marvelous tints and rugged beauty. How are Curly and the Codyites? Born actors, as are all cowboys. They are only a lot of children, and play acting is second nature to them. Why, they were so proud of the grease paint, they wore it day and night. They thought it enhanced their beauty, and refused to wash their faces all the time we were there. A phone call for Miss Farrar gave me an opportunity to inspect the collection of rare Japanese prints on the walls of the room. When she returned, she was still eager to recall her Cody experience with the gentlemanly range riders of the West. "I could tell you dozens of funny happenings out in Wyoming," she said. "It was real roughing it. I occupied a room directly over the bar room of the Cody Hotel, and I am afraid I interfered terribly with the free and easy joyousness that ordinarily went on in the room below. It seems that all the cowboys made it a point of honor not to shoot up through the ceiling while I was in my room. It was very thoughtful of them, a piece of delicate courtesy that I fully appreciated. But I never felt sure that some stranger might not saunter into the barroom unnoticed and send the contents of his shooting iron in my direction before his playfulness could be curbed. The attitude of those boys toward a woman is a very fine thing to see." End of chapter 6. Recording by Andrea Kotzer. Chapter 7 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Andrea Kotzer. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 7. Elsie Ferguson has decided convictions on the intellectual future of the silent stage. There may be such a thing as the art of interviewing. If so, it is not necessary to employ it when talking movies with Elsie Ferguson. A supply of what the lawyers call leading questions often figures as first aid to turning the flow of conversation into the proper channels, but it is not needed when the star of Sacred and Profane Love talks for publication. From the very nature of the task, an interviewer is somewhat limited as to method when he realizes that the charming young woman sitting opposite him must be made to utter words of wisdom or of wit, no matter how hopeless the case looks. The scribe may envy a cross-questioning attorney his untrammeled use of sarcasm and unpleasant fact, but he may not employ either one of them. Nothing is left him but tact, smiling, and unfailing tact. That was what was used the afternoon I called at the Park Avenue home of Miss Ferguson, but I did not supply it. The mistress of the house brought it into the room with her when she first entered, and used it so skillfully that all I had to do was to sit back in an easy chair and be entertained for something over an hour. If a mellow-toned clock hadn't chimed the hour of 6, there was no telling how much longer I might have stayed. Elsie Ferguson is a firm believer in the higher mission of the screen. Her opinion is based upon her experience as a star of both the spoken and the silent stage. She acted the character of Carlotta Peel in the stage version of Sacred and Profane Love, and has completed her interpretation of the same part in the pictured play of the Arnold Bennett story. After telling of her trip to the Philippines in the Far East last summer, and of watching Under the Greenwood Tree and The Marriage Price as they were run off at Banyo and Manila before the wondering eyes of the dark-skinned but attentive spectators, and of seeing herself in such strange surroundings, Miss Ferguson brought the conversation around to her faith in the steady upward trend of the moving picture, until it shall become the interpreter of the highest aspirations of humanity. "You put the entertaining qualities of a picture first, do you not?" I asked. "No, I put the real things of life first," was her reply. "It is quite right to make the production as attractive as possible, but the tinsel does not count unless the subject it sets off has the beauty that Keats describes in his Ode on a Grecian Urn. Beauty is truth, truth beauty. That is what makes the great dramatists of the past live on, and will keep the masterpieces of the screen alive." Elsie Ferguson's speaking voice is one of her chief charms. It is beautifully modulated and rich and full in tone. She talks well on a great variety of subjects and shows a real interest in them all. She leaves the atmosphere of the studio and the stage in the workshop and finds in her home influences that broaden and humanize her art. Her desire is for screen roles that show the finer emotions of woman. "That is what makes me hopeful for the moving picture and willing to devote the best that is in me to it," she explained. "I have felt at times that the accepted technique of the screen did not permit the actor to develop a scene to its fullest extent, that before one could get fairly into the thought and feelings of the character, the take was over and the action flashed to a new incident. The assurance that there has been a steady improvement in this direction and that the screen is getting nearer to a true understanding of its intellectual scope gives me courage and ambition." "You have had some excellent parts in the past, Miss Ferguson." "Yes," she admitted, "but I want the opportunity to do better things. If the works of writers like Barry, Henry Arthur Jones, and Arnold Bennett continue to be produced, they are bound to influence a taste for the finer and deeper studies of life." "How did you find the character of Carlotta in the screen version? Her opportunities, I mean." Miss Ferguson looked up at me with that meaning smile that is so familiar to her screen and stage following. "I cannot complain on that score," she replied. "Carlotta is just such a frank revelation of temperament, as was to be expected from Arnold Bennett, and I have been given every chance to transfer her to the screen." It was my turn to look at Miss Ferguson with a meaning smile. "A young woman," said I, "who reads Mademoiselle de Maupin at 18, falls instantly in love with an interpreter of Chopin, and becomes a famous novelist before she is 25, should prove a very interesting character." End of chapter 7. Recording by Andrea Kotzer.
Chapter 8 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Maria Casper. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 8. When Lillian Gish Goes on Location on a Wet and Uncomfortable Ice Cake in the Arctic Sea. It has not been settled that Lillian Gish is to make a picture at the North Pole, but one thing is positive: if she ever does start on such an expedition, or the scenario demands that she drift across the Arctic Ocean on a cake of ice, she will take an extra-large supply of grease paint with her. The Eskimos will imagine the beautifully pink tinted sticks are a superior brand of candles, and will proclaim them a great delicacy. The promise of a grease-paint feast at the end of the trip will secure the help and devotion of as many members of the Order of the Sons of the Midnight Sun as can crowd aboard the Gish Ice Cake Special. The above statements may sound like a wild flight of imagination. On the contrary, they are sober fact. After her experience in making the ice stuff for Way Down East, Lillian Gish is not to be frightened by such a simple bit of business as a 2 years' drift in the ice packs of the frigid zone. She is the sort of girl who goes where duty and the scenario send her. Besides, she will have her trusty sticks of grease paint with her, and will be able to laugh at the cold when it chases the mercury out through the lower end of the thermometer. For she has made a valuable discovery. Grease paint will not only prove an enticing article of food for the gentleman in fur pants, but a liberal coat of it on the tip of her nose will prevent that useful organ from freezing in the iciest of Arctic weather. Sitting in the corner room of her suite in the Savoy Hotel, which commands a glorious view of Central Park, Miss Gish gave me her rules for safely enjoying the new midwinter sport of ice-cake planing in a blizzard. Of course, she admitted, it isn't quite so pleasant as seaplaning in summer behind a fast motorboat, and it isn't at all likely that you'll grin any if the cake upsets and spills you into the water. But I've found out how to prevent your face from freezing, even after it becomes coated with ice. Whether or not you are a moving picture actress, put a good heavy grease paint makeup on your face, and you can defy the cold. That is what saved me from getting frostbitten cheeks while I was floating down the Connecticut River in January. Mr. Griffith hadn't any such protection on his face, and it was badly frostbitten before the ice scenes were finished. A long acquaintance with the two Gish girls led to a reference to our first meeting. It took place about 18 years ago. "Do you remember what happened that night?" I asked. "Of course I do," Lillian exclaimed quickly. "That was the night Dorothy saved the scene. Don't you remember, she had to go on the stage all alone, climb up on a chair, take a fire helmet from a nail on the wall, and carry the helmet off. It was very important business, and no one was on the stage with her. Don't you recall that the helmet had been forgotten, and just as soon as Dorothy saw that it wasn't there, she didn't wait to be told what to do, but ran off and got it from the property man, ran back on the stage with it, held it up to the audience, and then ran out of the room through another door. Wasn't that clever for a little girl of 5? "Yes, indeed," I replied. "I've seen big girls of 25 lose their presence of mind entirely in a similar situation." "Dorothy was always like that," said Lillian. I detected evidence of her future distinction then and there, and of her sister's present enviable reputation the next day, I remarked with pretended gravity. Lillian looked puzzled. "Why, how was that? What happened?" she asked. "Do you mean to tell me," I demanded, "that you have forgotten how I escorted you to a matinee at another theater, and that you gravely informed me, between the acts, that you went to a performance every time you had a chance because it was a great help to you in your work? Wasn't that clever for a little girl of 9? The now famous star of the shadow stage did not look at all displeased at the last question. "I must have been a funny little thing with my big ideas," she said. "On the contrary, you were very dignified, and I respected you terribly. You were so much in earnest, I had to, you know. You made me feel how I had wasted my own young years. At 9 I thought only of playing hooky from school, and of Chalk the Rabbit, and you sat there so quietly and watched that play with such understanding eyes that I looked back at 25 years' experience in the traffic of the theater and blushed for my own lack of achievement. By the way," I asked abruptly, "did you go through the Limehouse district of London when you were in England?" "Yes, Mr. Griffith had the story in mind when we were over after scenes for Hearts of the World. That trip was full of fine opportunities for me. We saw all the best performances in London and in Paris. The French actors are marvelous. And of course we visited Shakespeare's birthplace. Mary Anderson lives near there, at a place called Broadway. We had lunch at her home, but she was unable to meet us. Her daughter was taken ill suddenly, and our hostess had gone to the convent where she was at school. You've seen Mary Anderson act a great many times. What was she like? Very stately and beautiful, and a wonderful actress, wasn't she?" "Yes, her voice was one of her chief charms, rich and full like an organ." "Mine isn't a bit like that." That was said regretfully. "It's a very nice voice," I hastened to assure her, and then added, "and think all that you are saved by not being obliged to use it in portraying characters for the screen. Opera singers and actors on the stage are constantly paying big bills to throat specialists, and must be so careful not to get horsed up." "That is only one side of it," returned Miss Gish. "Movie actresses cannot get out of rehearsals by sending notes to the effect that they have a cold and dare not risk voice strain. But I want to know more about Mary Anderson. What was her most famous part?" "She made her greatest success in Winter's Tale. She played both Hermione and Perdita, and London went wild over her, as the expression has it. If you want an expert opinion of the way she acted the two parts, read William Winter's book, Shadows of the Stage." There were a number of books lying on a table. Lillian Gish opened one of the volumes and took out a slip of paper. "That's another book for my list," she remarked. When the name of the Winter work had been duly set down, she turned to me with a very earnest expression on her face. "Please give me the names of all the books which will help me," she said. "I realize that a screen actress has comparatively few years in which she will be accepted in juvenile parts. By the time I have reached that period of my career, I want to be as far advanced as possible in the art of the spoken stage. I love my screen work, and shall not abandon it until the camera forces me to do so. But I have my future to think of, and the camera isn't kind to a woman after her youth is past. So perhaps the salaries we receive are not so large after all." The entrance of the private secretary, whose chief duty is answering the fan letters that arrive on every mail, changed the trend of conversation, and I was handed a note from a youthful admirer of the Way Down East heroine. The writer had been told that the Gish sisters were twins, but she was still a little doubtful as to the truth of the information. "I wish you would tell me if you really are twins," she wrote. "A girl I know says she is sure that one of you was born in Massillon, Ohio, and the other in Chicago, so I guess you can't be twins, after all." End of chapter 8. Chapter 9 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Maria Casper. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 9. Talking It Over with Dorothy Gish After She Took That Romantic Trip to Greenwich, Connecticut. It wasn't the parrot's fault. I made the mistake of addressing him as Polly and asking him if he wanted a cracker. His name is John, and from the way he looked at me, I thought he was going to reply, "I wish somebody would bring me a stuffed club." He was a wise bird, all right, and on to his job. When I sat down near one of the windows overlooking Central Park, his back was to me, and he kept it turned, until Mrs. James Rennie entered the room. But when I finished congratulating the bride and resumed my seat, John was facing in my direction, and he never took his eyes off me until the outside door shut me from his view. Muffling the sound with my hand and speaking in a half-whisper, I leaned forward and inquired anxiously, "Is our feathered friend in your husband's pay?" "Why do you ask that?" said the young matron who is Dorothy Gish to the public, and whose sudden marriage, following that of the unexpected wedding of Constance Talmage to John Piologlu, was the first double-barreled romance in filmdom. "From the way the bird fixes me with its glittering eye," I explained, "I thought Mr. Rennie must have bribed it with a pound of sunflower seed to do guard duty while he's at the theater on matinee days." Mrs. Rennie was kind enough to laugh at my little joke, and to help it along by remarking, "You'd better be careful. John has been a member of the Gish family for 5 years, and we never know what he's going to say." "Nevertheless, let's talk about your husband. When did you first meet him?" 18 months ago. He played my husband in Remodeling a Husband, and he also played my husband in Flying Pat. "And now he's your husband in reality, and that's as it should be. He didn't have an opportunity in either of the pictures to woo and win you, and so, like a sensible man, he did it in earnest. The bride of a week thought for a second, and then her eyes took on the celebrated Dorothy Gish twinkle, as she exclaimed, "I remodeled my husband before I married him, didn't I? And that's the best plan. But isn't it funny how different things are from the way they were in the two pictures? I should never think of remodeling Mr. Rennie, because it isn't necessary. And in Flying Pat, my husband is supposed to know nothing about airplanes and to be dreadfully worried every time I go up. In reality, it is just the reverse. Mr. Rennie served 2 years in the Canadian Flying Corps, and we intend to take trips together in an airplane next summer. If the weather had been warmer, I suppose you would have flown to Greenwich and back in an airship built for two. Now tell me all about the double elopement." "It wasn't an elopement. Connie and I and Mr. Rennie and Mr. Pialoglu decided Christmas night to get married the next day, and so we went to Greenwich Sunday and kept our agreement. It had to be that way. Constance Talmage is my best friend, and we have always promised each other that we would be married at the same time." The D. Gish twinkle got into action again. "What is it?" I asked. "Connie was married first. It took only about 3 minutes, and James and I were pronounced man and wife 3 minutes later. Ever since then, Mrs. Pialoglu insists that I must listen to her when we are discussing domestic affairs. She says she has had more experience as a married woman." I looked at the slight figure sitting at the table in the center of the room, at the young girl who has brought smiles to the faces of thousands of human beings. Her right to happiness seemed to have a special claim of its own. She pointed to a bouquet of roses on the table, and explained that they had been sent her by Mr. Rennie's mother. Her unaffected pleasure and appreciation was in keeping with the honesty of her own nature. She has learned much of life, of its serious side, as well as of its springs of laughter, and has a thoughtful mind to go with her sunny disposition and loyal heart. "Do you ever find it embarrassing to be so well known to thousands of people?" I asked. "I'm not troubled that way very often," replied Dorothy, "but Charlie Chaplin must find it dreadful at times. He was at the theater the night the Russian ballet opened in Los Angeles, and the company recognized him immediately. He almost stopped the show. All of the dancers played right at him. After the first act, the manager came to Mr. Chaplin and told him the company had refused to go on with the performance until he went backstage and met them. He went, and the curtain didn't go up for half an hour. When he did return, he was smiling in the funniest way. They showed their admiration for him in every possible manner, and he was not permitted to leave until everybody, men and women, had embraced him and kissed him on both cheeks." "That was very kind of them, wasn't it?" "Yes, doubtfully. But I shouldn't have liked it, I'm sure, decidedly. It's the same with everyone. My Jap chauffeur was driving the machine for me one afternoon, when I noticed his eyes start to pop out of his head. 'What is it?' I asked. 'See, Miss Gish, please, Charlie Chaplin. The best-known actor who ever lived was just turning the corner.'" This chat with Dorothy Gish Rennie took place in the Gish suite at the Savoy Hotel. Learning that the young couple had been snapshotted by several enterprising newshounds, but that there were no group photographs of the Rennie family to be had, I arranged to drop in the next afternoon at the Rennie apartment near Gramercy Park and bring a camera with me. Arriving at the house, one glance showed that the entrance would make an effective background for the picture. The building is on a quiet street, and any young girl would be in love with the romantic-looking doorway. I should have liked to have taken a flashlight of the living room, with mine host before the tall fireplace and his wife sitting in the corner of the broad sofa and looking demurely dignified. But I didn't know anything about flashlights, and Mrs. Dorothy Gish Rennie didn't hold the pose but a second or two. Swinging the slender and correct walking stick she picked up in Paris last summer, she led the way from the room and down the stairs, with that pert carriage of her head so suggestive of a bright-eyed wren, although her gray coat and turban failed to carry out the simile. The posing in the doorway was soon over. Several of the neighbors across the street stood at their windows and watched while the camera was leveled at the newlyweds. All womankind dearly love a bride who is also a celebrity. End of chapter 9.
Chapter 10 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is the LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Louise Glown's touching human document story is interrupted by the nameless one. In many ways, the publicity promoter is an asset to a moving picture star, but it isn't a bit of use to an interviewer when one of these human interrogation points is after simple facts, rather than seeking to record the spectacular flight of a soaring, not to say daring, fancy. I found this out when I had a chat with Louise Glown. Her enterprising press agent made the preliminary arrangements and offered to be present. Said I to myself, "All right, young man, but this affair is for the sole purpose of picking up a few little anecdotes about Miss Glown that may interest the public, and you're not going to ring in a lot of publicity about her latest picture." It took quick work to head him off. I'm not going to give him the satisfaction of using his name, but the moment the introduction was over and we were seated in Miss Glown's suite in the Claridge, he started to get in his best professional touches, and directed my attention to a number of photographs on the table. "Here are some of Miss Glown's pictures in the costumes she uses in Sex. Isn't this stunning?" he demanded, and held out a photograph of the actress that would make any woman with a leaning toward Paris gown stop, look, and wish for one like it. I pretended to give the photograph a careless glance and tossed it back on the pile. Turning to Miss Glown with my most reassuring smile, I spoke as one who had no interest in such matters. "Tell me something about yourself that will make a good story," I began.
"Tell him about your 24 gowns for the new picture," put in eagerly the one who shall be nameless. "Here is the latest thing in dancing frocks. Miss Glown wears this one." I merely waved the picture aside.
"We may as well come to an understanding at once, young man," said I. "This is to be an interview, and not an excuse for grabbing space to advertise the wardrobe of your star. The contents of a press sheet is very important matter when printed in the proper place, but I want short human documents about Miss Glown that smacketh not of the publicity stunt." Once more I turned my back on the nameless one. "Have you a straight picture, Miss Glown?" I asked. "Only this one with my dog," replied the impersonator of the lone wolf's daughter, picking up an at-home picture of herself sitting on a bench under a tree and holding an alert-looking Boston bull in her arms.
"Fine dog. Where is he now? Out in California?"
"Yeah, poor little fellow. He broke his leg and I had to leave him behind."
"Tell Mr. Weitzel about the part he was going to play in Sex,"
came promptly from the Los Angeles word juggler, who was turning over the leaves of a scrapbook and giving out signs of a feverish desire to read aloud one or two dozen articles of his own composition touching upon the merits of the Glam releases. For the third time I turned to Miss Glam. "Will you kindly ask this publicity person of yours to leave the room, or henceforth hold his peace?" I almost implored.
"A press agent who holds his peace can't hold his job," interjected the irrepressible one, before Miss Glown could reply to my request. "And it's straight goods about the dog's part in Sex," he added.
Once more I endeavoured to pursue my talk with Miss Glown. "If anything of the amusing nature really did take place while you were at work upon the picture, I know that your many admirers would be delighted to learn the particulars," I remarked, with all the dignity at my command.
"Several funny things happened," replied Miss Glown, "but the most amusing little human document I recall was the 5-year-old child we used in another picture. The little girl was as bright as a new pin, and a born actress, but her mother instinct completely ruined quite a number of feet of film when she came on in one scene leading a 3-year-old boy. The little fellow was wearing a pair of rompers, and looked so cute and cunning. His sister was supposed to be very proud of him, and she did this so naturally that we were all charmed with her. But when the cameraman started to take the scene, the little tot put in a piece of business that broke all of us up and made a retake necessary. Just as she got well on the scene with her brother, she discovered that one side of his rompers had become unfastened, and she immediately dropped on her knees and proceeded to make him shipshape. The scene itself was a serious one,
and when we grown-ups couldn't restrain our laughter, there was nothing to do but retake the scene. She didn't get scolded for it, of course. Not the first time, but that pair of rompers was cursed with buttonholes that were too large for the buttons, and one side or the other would manage to become unfastened before the scene was completed. The little girl would try her best to take no notice of the exposé, but modesty always triumphed over art, and down she would go on her knees and repair the damage. Miss Glam laughed heartily at the recollection of the incident, and so did I. But the nameless one looked pained. "Oh, I say, Miss Glam," he protested, with near tears in his voice, "he can't use that story. It's about an old picture. Please tell Mr. Weitzel about your Boston Bull and why he didn't appear in sex." The owner of the dog looked pensive, and again picked up the at-home picture. "We were terribly disappointed," she said. "The poor little fellow knows so many clever tricks that we concluded to use him in the photoplay, and Mr. Sullivan, the scenario writer, wrote in a part for him. The day before we were to start rehearsing his scenes, he ran away, a thing he had never done before. He was gone 2 weeks, and when he did return, his leg was broken. We couldn't wait for it to mend, and so his part in the picture had to be cut out." "But that didn't hurt the picture any," spoke up the faithful dispenser of important information. "And Miss Glam's 2 dozen gowns that she wears in sex are the finest examples of the Paris dressmaker's art ever brought to this country." Determined to shut off this stream of eloquence by the only possible means, I brought the interview to an abrupt close, and bade Miss Glam good afternoon. As I stated in the opening paragraph, no publicity promoter can put it over on me when I'm after a human interest story. It may be his duty to get the name of his star and a list of her gowns into print as many times as possible, but he must get along without any help from me.
End of chapter 10.
Chapter 11 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Greg Giordano. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 11. D.W. Griffith. D.W. Griffith's screen version of The Two Orphans would fill its author with awe. Trolling through the streets of old Paris, the Paris that saw the Revolution, and the head of Dantin roll into the basket at the foot of the guillotine, I stopped and recalled the first time I witnessed the stage presentation of The Two Orphans, and I thought of the remark of the aristocratic Chevalier Vaudry about having seen one of the Beaumarchais plays that contained revolutionary sentiments which the police had forbidden, but the people took sides with the author, and the king was compelled to yield. Des Prayels. The king compelled to yield? If that is true, royalty has lowered its dignity. Vaudrey. No, Marquis. It is the people who are asserting theirs. Des Prayels. Why, if this goes on, they will not be satisfied until they suppress one's titles and privileges. Vaudrey. That would not at all surprise me. Picard, the chevalier's valet, laughs. Why, Picard? That seems to amuse you. Picard. Excuse me, sir, but that is as ridiculous as though you were to say that one of these days the Parisians would rise and demolish the Bastille. Vaudrey. Who knows? Picard. What? The Bastille? Well, when that time comes, everything will be upside down. They won't even respect a nobleman's valet. Vaudrey. Nor a nobleman either. Here all reference to the tragic unrest that was to result in the French Revolution ends, so far as the play is concerned. But it is into this momentous period of the world's history that the two orphan girls enter when they alight from the Normandy coach. And it is upon this hint that D.W. Griffith has seized the comprehensive scope of the screen and used the tragic episode of Dantin's execution as part of the atmosphere in his silent version of the D.N.R.A. story. The long life and immense popularity of The Two Orphans would tempt any producer to put it on the screen, with its appealing story and the vigor and variety of its characters and incidents. The City by the Seine, which Griffith has built on the shores of Long Island Sound, is an impressive collection of ancient structures with the grim old Bastille facing the fountain in the center of the square, and the keen knife of the guillotine gleaming in the sunlight at the lower end of the street, a sinister and repulsive object. As I came to the lodge gate at the entrance of the studio grounds, a hurrying crowd of French citizens were disappearing under an arch behind a rude cart in which rode a young girl, her arms bound behind her, and a look of resignation on her face. By the time I reached the side of the arch, the last of the excited mob was out of sight, but the voice of someone in authority could be heard urging everyone to remember that the girl in the cart was about to have her head chopped off, and was not taking a ride for her health. It was not the voice of D.W. Griffith, but that of his assistant. I stole around to the end of the set and glanced into the square. The famous director was standing on the camera platform, calmly smoking a cigar, and giving an occasional order intended only for the ear of his second-in-command. It is related of D.W. Griffith that when one of the biggest scenes in Intolerance was ready to be photographed, word was brought to him that the engine which hurled the stones during the assault of the army of Cyrus on the walls of Babylon had broken down and must be repaired. Everything else was in readiness. The thousands of men and women were in their positions, the cauldrons of oil lighted, and delay meant a serious expense. The situation would have driven most directors into a justifiable rage. "How long will it take to fix the catapult?" asked Mr. Griffith. "Half an hour," he was informed. "Go ahead," was all he said. When the engine was fixed, work was resumed on the scene as though nothing had happened. In the same unperturbed spirit, he listens to criticism of himself and his pictures. Upon being told that the one fault of a certain picture of his was its length, he exhibited no resentment, but replied smilingly, "That is said generally of my pictures, but pictures should not be restricted as to length. The development of character is the essential thing, and time should be taken to do this thoroughly."
The moving picture, he concluded, is becoming more and more like a story by Dickens.
Not The Tale of Two Cities, which is drama first of all, but like David Copperfield. I walked over to the reverse side of the arch, and presently the mob and the cart came trooping back through it, and I got a smile of recognition and a wave of the hand from the blind Louise. The next instant Sister Dorothy hove into sight, and I was treated to another smile and a sample of her wicked little wink. There was a hurried right-about face on the part of everyone, and then the cart went plunging ahead, with its sad-faced victim, Henriette, pale and torn with anguish, and the frenzied mob bringing up the rear. It was a raw, bleak day, and just suited to the mood of the shouting mob in the tragic scene. Tragedy of this sort, deep and relentless, is where Griffith excels. Broken Blossoms is of the same order of story. When the first $3 movie was shown at the George M. Cohan Theater in New York, D.W. Griffith remarked to me, "Broken Blossoms will do more for the moving picture than was accomplished by The Birth of a Nation." I didn't recognize this when the picture was finished, but since coming to New York and putting the matter to the test, it is plainly evident. I did not think that a simple story, told in picture form and running only an hour and a half, would take such a firm hold on the public, but the opening night at the George M. Cohan Theater showed how little a man can guess the amusement business. Out west they preferred True Heart Susie. Here in New York we have had a number of the more critical sort of amusement seekers in to see Broken Blossoms, 3 and 4 times, and the house has been sold out every performance.
So the public does not put the spectacle first of all, Mr. Griffith?
It certainly looks like it, was the reply.
Please explain in what way Broken Blossoms will benefit the moving picture.
It will help to classify it. There clearly is a demand for a form of screen drama that will attract a class of patrons who do not care for the regulation program. The price of admission does not weigh in the matter at all. This portion of the public is now paying $3 to see Broken Blossoms. It is related closely to the public which attends such stage productions as the Barrymores in The Jest.
Have you ever thought, Mr. Griffith, that there are two forms of screen fiction, the photodrama and the photonovel? One secret of D.W. Griffith's success is his open mind.
No, I never have, he said, but it is a good idea.
Would not the general acceptance of this fact enlarge the scope of the picture? I asked.
Very much so, was the reply. Like every other form of art, the screen is bound to develop the specialist, who will be known for his particular brand of picture.
At present, he was reminded, directors in most cases have no clearly defined school of their own. They see some new thing applied successfully to the making of a photoplay, and they introduce it into their next picture without stopping to find out if it belongs there.
"We all have a great deal to learn about this profession of ours," remarked Mr. Griffith. "An entertainment which is completed at one sitting is not like a book, which can be put down when the reader pleases, and picked up again when he is ready to resume his reading. And it is this which has led to the preference for the straightaway story." Another interested watcher that day was the Romanian poet and dramatist, Miss Adriel Val, who was visiting the Griffith studio for the purpose of learning how motion pictures are made in America. When the march to the guillotine was finished, Lillian and Dorothy Gish came over to where Miss Val was standing and chatted with her, while a body of troops on horseback dashed across the square and straight up to the entrance of the Bastille, in a vain attempt to ride right into the prison, before the massive doors could be closed. The scene was shot several times, but the shouts of the horsemen and the clatter of their horses' hooves as they came tearing out of a side street and plunged ahead without slacking speed until within a few feet of the doors gave a fresh thrill to the scene every time it was repeated. "What wonderful riders those soldiers are!" exclaimed Miss Adriel Val. "And the horses are wonderful, too. They seem to enjoy what they are doing." "They are all cow-ponies, and the men are cowboys and stunt riders," Lillian Gish explained. Monty Blue, who was playing Dantan, came hobbling up with the help of a cane, and something was said about a badly bruised knee, a souvenir of a nasty fall the day before, when there was also wild riding, and one of the horses slipped and threw his rider. Mr. Griffith joined the party at this point, and led the way into the studio, where there was a grateful sense of warmth, and workmen were rapidly demolishing the great hall in which Dantan and Camille and their companions were condemned to die. Dantan, with all his dross, he was a man, Carlyle says of him, fiery real from the great fire bosom of nature herself. As for Monty Blue, I have Mr. Griffith's word, for it is that his Dantan has the wild revolutionary force and manhood demanded of this farmer's son, who at one time ruled France by force of his inflexible will. This day Monty was only half as impressive as a Dantan as he should have been, but there was a reason for it. His coat and hat and the lines of his face were those of the French leader of 1792. But his feet and legs belonged to the year 1921. Above his waist he was the famous head of the French Revolution. Below his vest pockets and his Republican sash he wore the long trousers and laced shoes of the present, a time-saving sartorial arrangement popular with moving picture actors when there are only close-ups to be taken. A walk about the studio disclosed several bits of local color in the nature of dens and parts of the Reign of Terror settings not to be found in the original play. There isn't the slightest doubt that if Adolphe Deharnais were alive today, the D.W. Griffith screen version of The Two Orphans would fill its author with amazement and awe. End of Chapter 11. Recording by Greg Giordano, Newport Richey, Florida.
Chapter 12 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Kevin Davidson. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 12. Star author stunster Hutchison is hanged to everyone's calm satisfaction but his own. If an ad writer were titling this article, it probably would read, "How Hutchinson Hatched Hurricane Hutch." The star author stuntster, who daily and cheerfully risks his life and limbs in the interests of a Pathé serial, has never had much of a voice in deciding how, where, or when he was to adopt a new profession, and give concrete evidence that a man never knows what he can do until he finds himself doing it. Fate has seized Charles Hutchison by the back of the neck and the slack of his knickerbockers, and metaphorically pitched him headfirst off 20-story buildings and shot him over burning volcanoes and through dangerous and deadly rapids so often that he has grown to like the sensation and learned how to land on his feet. Early environment, as usual, took a hand in determining the path that a small boy who used to haunt the coal barges and boats along the Pittsburgh waterfront was to follow to fame and a movie star income. Young Charlie Hutchison just didn't know how to take a dare, but delighted in leading the gang at doing high dives into the dark and soapy waters of the Allegheny River, and scampering around on the masts and backstays of the ships that were moored to the levee. With this bunch of youthful daredevils, it was a case of the higher the fewer, and Charlie would have counted that day lost when he did not pull off more than one stunt that only he had the nerve to get away with. "What was the first nervy thing you did when you became an actor?" I asked him. "Applied for a part. At least that is what the manager told me after my opening performance," he replied. "Just what did he say to you?" "Young man, if it took nothing but nerve to succeed in this business, you'd be the greatest actor who ever lived."
"And you took the hint?"
"Yes, but not after I was pitched into moving pictures." "You mean, like the majority of actors? I thought I was in hard luck when an empty pocketbook forced me to accept my first movie engagement."
To sit and listen to the calm, well-modulated voice of Charles Hutchison, and to note his perfectly controlled nerves, clear skin, and muscular figure, is to understand that he keeps himself in the pink of physical condition. When a man risks his life several times a day, he cannot afford to take any chances on weakened nerves or muscles. Charles Hutchison lives a model life. "How did you come to be a stunt star?" I inquired.
"By first becoming a scenario writer," he replied.
"You mean you thought it best to learn all branches of serial making?"
"No, I did it in self-defense. I was engaged to play the heavy in a serial that was submitted to Pathé for distribution and turned down by them because it did not have any more thrills in it than the average five-reel melodrama. I told the producer what I thought should be done with a serial scenario, and he told me to go ahead and write one. When I had finished, he said it was a good scenario, except that he didn't know anyone who could do the stunts."
"That put it up to you?"
"Yes, I felt that the only way to thrill a serial audience was to double the danger of the stunts. I told the producer this, and he laughed and said that I was like some of the scenario writers who sent in scripts filled with impossible situations that got the hero into all sorts of desperate scrapes, but suggested no way by which he could get out.
Like the man who built the chicken coop of laths and then called his wife to admire his work," said I.
"What did she say?" asked Mr. Hutchison.
"It's a beautiful chicken coop, my dear," she exclaimed, "but how are you going to get out?"
He had built himself inside of the coop, and the only thing for him to do was to knock it to pieces again, which he did with all the vigor that his good right arm, assisted by a hammer and a wild rage, could bring to his aid.
"How do you find time to work on a scenario?" was my next question. The stunt star gave a funny little chuckle.
"By getting so smashed up in a leap for life that I am forced to keep to my room and turn to scenario writing as the best way to occupy my mind. That is how Hurricane Hutch came to be written after I had injured my arm in making Wolves of Culture."
"You must have had some close calls in your time."
"Oh, yes. One of the closest was in my first stunt picture. I was supposed to be hanged, but it came dangerously near being a reality. The producer, who was also the director, rigged up some sort of scheme that was intended to keep the strain off my neck, but after several husky cowboys had eagerly and lustily hoisted me into the air, the rope slipped, or something went wrong, and my supply of oxygen was completely cut off. I tried to speak, but couldn't, and my realistic struggles were taken for my intense devotion to my art. The more I kicked and writhed, the better pleased was the director. As he gave the signal to let me down, he remarked that I'd done fine, and the scene wouldn't have to be taken over again. When I was able to speak, I assured him I was satisfied if he was. About 5 seconds more, that dance upon nothing, and I would have kept right on into the hereafter.
Why don't you let some of the other members of the company take a chance at going on the same journey?
Again the stunt star gave his funny little chuckle. I do sometimes, without intending it. This happened in The Great Gamble. In one scene, I had business of defending myself from a gang of toughs by hitting one of them over the head with a chair. The chair had been sawed in two and fastened together so lightly that it would fall to pieces at the slightest contact with a bad man's skull. We all examined it and convinced ourselves of that, especially the actor who was to play the part of this particular bad man.
What happened?
In the struggle, someone moved the chair.
And you picked up the wrong one.
Naturally. It was several days before that unfortunate bad man got back to the studio, and the cut on his forehead didn't heal for weeks.
Was he resentful against you for the accident?
Oh, no. He was paid to take chances. Besides, he had a good laugh, with the rest of us, at a report that was sent back to the studio after the scene had been inspected by a committee at the office.
Did the members of the committee find the scene too realistic?
On the contrary. They gave it as their opinion that when I knocked the poor chap insensible with the perfectly good chair, he did a very unnatural fall, and advised that we take the scene over again.
End of chapter 12. Recording by Kevin Davidson. www.blogordie.com.
Chapter 13 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Andrea Kotzer. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 13, Why Mae Murray's First Serious Role May Not Prove to Be Such a Bad Blunder After All. Certain fortunate individuals are said to have fallen into a fortune or walked right into success. Mae Murray danced her way into the movies and continued to balance herself on her toes and step through the scenes of her first pictures until one day she made a discovery. Dancing is a very pretty accomplishment, but acting is something else again. When one is born with the rhythm and swing of the dance at the end of one's toes, and is also endowed with a face and figure that suggest one of those lightly laughing, gaily tripping maidens in flowing drapery whom artists love to draw, scampering about in the moonlight, it is the most natural thing in the world that only part suited to such a personality should fall to her share. Joyous youth is always a beautiful thing to see. A pretty pouting creature, half child, half woman, will never lack a generous following. To make the world give back smile for smile, that is the business of the ingenues of the stage and the screen. And so Mae Murray played her parts and became mistress of the arch glance and the thousand and one tricks of the ingenuous maidens of histrionic fiction. Then someone blundered, and a scenario was selected for her that had all the light and shade of life in it. The heroine was a Mormon maiden who danced and sang and climbed up into trees and was as carefree and happy as any other normal young girl until the shadow of the church that ruled in Utah at the time fell across her path and turned her life into a tragedy. A fine part, indeed, for a nimble-footed young woman who had graduated from the celebrated follies of good neighbor Ziegfeld. Not that Mae Murray failed to deliver the goods. Quite the contrary. The rather amazing thing about it, though, was the way she put over the heavy emotional scenes. There is nothing on record to indicate just where and how she learned the secret, but there isn't the slightest doubt that she felt, and made the spectator feel to the full, the mental anguish of the little emigrant girl who was forced to become one of the several wives of a Mormon elder. I was present at a showing of the picture, and I haven't yet recovered from my astonishment at the depth of emotion put into her acting by the ex-dancer. There were brief moments when she just stood still and let the soul of the woman shine through her eyes. That's a good old trusty way of saying it, and much better than I can do. There was one drawback to this new and unsuspected phase of Mae Murray's acting ability, however. She had let it be known too early in her screen career. The transition from the dancing ingenue who awakened only the pleasant emotions to the actress of serious purpose who took her toll of the spectator's tears was too sudden, and the public showed its resentment by treating the picture with indifference. A series of parts followed that asked merely that she furnish amusement for the large and easily diverted portion of humanity whose highest meed of praise consists of the expression, "Ain't she cute?" Being faithful and diligent by choice, the star of these good-natured travesties on life gave them all that they demanded of her. But she never forgot those moments when she knew, without being told, that she had made the Mormon girl live and suffer. Here was her goal, to depict life whole. The screen could mirror not only the laughter, but the tears of her fellow creatures. She would never be satisfied until her right was recognized to embody the full round of emotions in the characters given her to act. Mae Murray's chance came, of course. Determination and native ability form a combination which is bound to open the door of opportunity sooner or later.
All that was needed was the right role and a director with vision enough to put the right woman in it. George Fitzmaurice cast her for the heroine of On with the Dance and proceeded to utilize not only her carefully cultivated toes, but her innate grasp of the art which holds the mirror up to nature. A director in luck, say I. We have all seen excellently trained actresses playing the parts of celebrated dancers and have accepted their impersonations until they started to dance. Here was a dancer who made you believe in her acting every second she was on the scene. There were moments when the sensationalism and the touch of the bizarre in the story and in its production faded from sight, and you were conscious of nothing but a woman fighting for happiness against almost overwhelming odds, of mental suffering, deep and poignant, revealed without physical excess of any description. A director in luck, again, say I. For further proof, there is the story of the theatrical manager who bought a play with a bareback rider for a heroine. A firm believer in realism, the manager would engage a real circus rider for the part and teach her to act. He consulted the proprietor of a circus, a man wise in the ways of queens of the arena. "Nothing doing, Bo," was the verdict of this Solomon of the Sawdust. "Bareback riders ain't got the pipes or the training for the job. You'll have to take one of your actorines and learn her to ride." While On with the Dance was in the making, I sat in the studio projection room with Mae Murray and we watched the running off of several of its serious scenes. It was the first time I had seen her do anything along such lines since her acting of the Mormon girl. There was the same sure revelation of deep feeling, the same convincing glimpses of the inborn gift of adequate dramatic expression. One attitude as she stood looking out of a window reminded me of a similar moment in the acting of Mrs. Fisk in one of her first tragic parts. I said so involuntarily, and was given to understand that the screen actress at my side fully appreciated the implied compliment. "Do you really like me in these serious scenes?" asked Miss Murray when the showing was finished. "I think they'll be the best things you will do in the picture," was my reply. This has been true of the later pictures in which she has appeared. There are a number of situations in The Gilded Lily that are made finely effective by the tense emotion in the face of the woman who stands motionless and contemplates the wreck of her happiness. Her latest picture, Peacock Alley, is filled with the tinsel of life, but has its moments of real feeling, and to them the star responds with admirable potency. The secret of Miss Murray's success is not hard to find. It is the same old guidepost that marks the path of all the folk who do worthwhile things in this world, a real and abiding sincerity. Perhaps putting Mae Murray into the part of the little Mormon girl was not a fatal blunder after all. End of chapter 13. Recording by Andrea Kotzer.
Chapter 14 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Kevin Davidson. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 14. Nazimova follows the tragedy of Camille with a comedy performance of fine humor. The performance took place in the Crystal Room of the Ritz after the first New York showing of Camille. Dumas' pathetic story, with Nazimova as the heroine, had been unrolled upon the silver sheet in the grand ballroom, and the Lady of Camellias had died peacefully among the pillows of the largest bed ever found outside of a futuristic drawing or the domestic establishment of the late multi-married Brigham Young, Esquire. The comedy which followed the tragedy was quite as skillfully acted as the screen drama, and indicated with graphic ease the wide range of the principal player's art, a delightful performance from every point of view. Nazimova, on either the stage or the screen, is a fascinating personality, but when she decides to enact a comedy in a drawing-room, and permits her guests to share in that performance, the affair becomes unique and the result a triumph. As I descended the circular staircase and paused in the doorway of the richly decorated reception room, my attention was attracted to the figure of a woman in a long opera cloak who was standing at the farther side of the apartment.
Her back was toward me, but her becomingly cropped hair and the quick shrug of her expressive shoulders told me where Alla Nazimova was to be found. There were 100 or more persons present, half of them newspaper and magazine writers, and all eager and clamorous, and bent upon obtaining the material for an interview. They surrounded the Russian actress in groups of a dozen to twice that number, and beamed upon the object of their homage, while the more fortunate ones, comprising the envied inner circle, told her of the pleasure they had derived from the picture just shown, and asked all sorts of leading questions, which their hostess parried with ready strokes of polished wit, or answered with encouraging freedom. To a woman of Nazimova's brilliancy and love of the spoken stage, this close contact with a completely won audience was as incense to her nostrils, and she handled the quickly varying situations in which she found herself with enchanting ease. On the outer edge of the circle, or bringing up newly arrived scribes to be introduced, were the members of the Metro publicity staff. The less favored or non-scribbling guests sat about on the luxurious divans and chairs, and smiled approvingly at the human interest of the comedy and the cleverness with which it was being played. A sudden break in the ranks of the faithful and admiring circle gives my good friend Jack Medder an opportunity to try to present me, but the line closes in again before he can indicate the precise individual who bears the name he mentions. In place of bending over the hand of Madame and delivering the pretty speech I have prepared, I find myself gazing at the long neck of a tall man in a gray suit, who is reeling off an astonishing collection of choice compliments at bewildering speed. This goes on for several moments while Nazimova takes calm puffs through a foot-long cigarette holder and watches the speaker with a look of deep interest, or varies it with an unfathomable smile. In the midst of one of the fluent gentleman's finest remarks, there is a small-sized imitation of a bit of massed football play by the Metro publicity staff. The tosser-off of compliments is forced into the background, and the cause of the strategic attack goes sallying away across the room, escorted by a stout person with an experienced eye, who leads her to a sofa near a tray of denatured cocktails and other pretty soft drink. Here the two engage in animated conversation, apparently oblivious to everyone but themselves, after Nazimova has rubbed her left shoulder with a gesture expressive of great bodily suffering and demurely protested, "My poor arm is broken." A brief respite from the polite but insistent questioning of the crowd, and a new army of besiegers prepared to advance. Before they can do so, there is a little cry of delight from this latest of Camille's, and she is on her feet and is darting toward an elderly woman who has just entered the room. The next instant Nazimova is holding her in a close embrace and is kissing her with great fervor and showering her with endearing names in her native tongue. It is all Russian and temperamental and charmingly sincere. After this fashion the comedy goes on, 50 or more persons to be listened to, and sent away smiling and agreeably impressed. That requires much tact. Also, there is a scant 2 hours in which to complete the pleasant task. One must see to it that the play is speeded up. Once more, Nazimova is the center of a chattering throng, and I hear one of the young women asked, "Are you going to let your hair grow now, madame?" As the actress puts up her hand and carefully smooths down her becoming crop, Nazimova shakes her head. "I am to play a boy in my next picture," she replies. There is another brief break in that charmed inner circle, and I find myself thrust to the fore directly in front of Nazimova. She is talking with 3 well-known movie magazine writers, and furnishing them all with valuable copy. This continues for several minutes. Then, with unexpected suddenness, she looks in my direction, evidently recognizes a familiar face, and crosses to me quickly, with a gesture of welcome and the greeting, "Why, how do you do? I am so glad you have arrived." We have never met before, but the meaning of it all reaches me as we shake hands, and I manage to pick up the cue and keep to the spirit of the scene with my reply. We move a few steps beyond the waiting group, and the Nazimova version of Camille is discussed with interesting frankness by the Russian actress. But first she says, "Pardon me for greeting you as I did, but I mistook you for the gentleman who played my grandfather in Out of the Fog." I set her right as to my name, and try not to betray my amusement at the deft piece of business with which she brought a new character into the action. "Camille and Out of the Fog are my favorite screen productions," she declares. I remind her of the big moment in the latter picture when, as the youthful and unsophisticated heroine, and dressed in torn shirt and patched trousers, she comes into the lighthouse carrying one end of the cot that supports a young mother and her newborn child. The look of exaltation she bestows upon her grandfather and tells him that she has learned one of the great mysteries of life. In spite of his carefully laid plans to keep her in ignorance of the secret of motherhood, the character could not be in stronger contrast than to that of the disillusioned favorite of the Paris underworld, with her jewels and the autre gowns and the bizarre settings of the place she calls home. I speak of this, and Nazimova answers with a shrug and a smile, and adjusts her opera cloak, which might have been worn by the present-day Camille of her picture. "I have been told that Camille's house does not look like a home, and that is true," she says. "But what of it? Women like Camille do not have homes. They merely have places where they exist. The interior settings of your Camille, with their windows like big round eyes, and the general effect of an Aubrey Beardsley drawing, reflect upon the spirit of the locale," I remarked. By this time I am deeply interested in all that is being said to me, and am eager to pursue the subject further, but I am reckoning without mine hostess. It is time to place me on the toboggan, another of those conscientious but disconcerting metro publicity boomers is approaching, with an anxious-looking young woman from an out-of-town daily at his side, and I have given Nazimova a beautiful opening. "You admire the settings, then?" she asks. "Yes," I reply, "they are so daringly symbolic." "Come with me and admire the artist who drew them. She is a charming girl," exclaims the actress, and before I have quite grasped that this is my dismissal, I am being led rapidly toward a distant group surrounding a tall young woman with brilliant eyes and lips. "Miss Rambova, here is a gentleman who admires your settings." Nazimova calls to her, and we shake hands. Natasha Rambova is a newcomer among moving picture artists, but her first commission shows that she belongs to the seekers after new methods of scenic expression. "The gentleman says that your settings are symbolic," explained the screen Camille, and exchanges smiles with the artist. "I hope that everyone will make the same discovery," remarked Miss Rambova. "There is no mistaking them," I remarked in my own defense, and think hard, but uselessly, for something reasonably clever to add. But it is not necessary. Miss Rambova branches off to the rocky road before an ambitious designer of movie settings, who forgets that directors may not see things from the same optical and financial angle. Nazimova stands near us, a sympathetic listener when not joining in the conversation. Then I realize she has gone. I look around. She is lighting a cigarette at one of the small tables. Presently she joins a new group of arrivals, and the comedy is again being acted with all the technical skill and dazzling effect of a stage or screen tour de force, and no one is enjoying it more than Nazimova herself. End of chapter 14. Recording by Kevin Davidson. www.blogordie.com
Chapter 15 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by L. D. Hamilton. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 15. Mary Pickford is willing to admit she did not see the funny side of the joke herself. A family affair, I would call it, the Fairbankses being the family in the case, and the affair, the friendly chat I had with them just before they sailed for Europe. I dropped in on them on a busy day, but I didn't apologize. Every other day was quite as busy for them, generally more so. I was at the opening in New York of The Three Musketeers and heard the star of the picture when he stood up and implored the men and women who crowded the aisle in front of his box to return to their seats so that the entertainment could start. A living close-up of Douglas and his homegrown mustache was a powerful magnet for any crowd, and he was flanked on the left by no less a celebrity than Charles Chaplin, also of the movies, immaculately garbed and effectually disguised by reason of having left his familiar lip decoration on his makeup shelf. But neither Doug nor Charlie was the chief cause of the demonstration, and they knew it, and were proud and happy to have it that way. Mary Pickford sat at Douglas Fairbanks' right. It was she the crowd wanted to see at close range. It milled up and down the aisle and voiced its admiration with an enthusiastic frankness that must have sounded like sweet music to the head of the House of Fairbanks. At the Ritz, it was Mrs. Fairbanks I went to see, but it was her husband whom I saw first. The sound of several voices and animated discussion floated along the hall that ran through the center of the suite, while I sat in a reception room and waited for the lady to appear, as the mid-Victorian novelists used to put it. Presently, there was a quick step along the hall. I rose expectantly and moved forward. Douglas D'Artagnan Fairbanks walked into the room, made a characteristic lurch for a telephone on the opposite wall, and called for a number. I sat down again and kept as still as a mouse. At the end of 3 seconds, Mr. Fairbanks turned and saw me. He smiled a greeting, and we chatted of the opening of The Three Musketeers while he held the receiver to his ear. In the middle of telling of the next swashbuckling gentleman he intends to animate for the screen, he broke off to give some instructions to the person at the other end of the telephone. He then excused himself and hurried back to the family conference. While I was trying to guess what name Mr. Fairbanks intended to mention when the phone cut him off, more footsteps came along the hall. But I did not hear them. As a consequence, Mary Pickford was standing in front of me and holding out her hand before I could get to my feet. And, of course, she smiled, and the glow of it performed its usual quick magic. If I had never seen nor heard of her before, I should have known instantly why she is, well, why she is Mary Pickford. We shook hands. Then she sat in front of me on a low divan and talked of the making of Little Lord Fauntleroy. I could visualize her as Cedric Errol. She looked so slight and trim, but as Dearest, his mother. I glanced at her again, and couldn't for the life of me see how, even with all the tricks of the trade at her disposal, she was going to make the grade. "Tell me about Fauntleroy. Did it give you any good laughs while you were working on it?" was my first leader. Mrs. Douglas Fairbanks looked very serious and thoughtful. "I don't remember any, but I'll ask Douglas," she said. "But something of an amusing nature must have happened," I protested. Again, Mrs. Douglas Fairbanks gave the matter serious consideration and admitted I was right. "I didn't see the funny side of it myself," she explained. "In fact, it gave me a regular stage fright, but Douglas and Brother Jack had a good laugh over it." "What did you do? Put on Dearest's wig when you were dressed for Little Lord Fauntleroy? Or was it the other way about?" "No, it wasn't anything like that. You know, just here, the telephone rang." Mary Pickford Fairbanks walked over and took down the receiver, and I got an insight into a side of her character that neither I nor her millions of admirers have ever suspected. The phone conversation was of a business nature, and the little woman at the Pickford end of the wire was strictly business. Her chief cameraman had called her up to get instructions about how to deal with a certain matter. And when Miss Pickford finished her orders, he knew exactly what to say to the person under discussion. His employer was perfectly calm and considerate as she gave her orders, gracious almost, but firm. She didn't say anything about consulting anyone, but settled the matter right off the reel. I also got the impression that it was a habit of hers to do this, and I was sure of it from the way she told her husband what she had done when he came into the room for a moment. After his D'Artagnan Fairbanks walk had carried Doug back into the family consulting room, Mary Pickford came over to the divan, and I was told the amusing incident that wasn't funny to her. It was decided that the cast for Little Lord Fauntleroy should all be six-footers. Both men and women, explained the hero-heroine of the Francis Hodgson Burnett story. I was to play an 8-year-old boy part of the time, you know, and it wasn't the easiest thing in the world for me to look it. This was said soberly, but demurely. And so all of your actors came high, in inches, at least, I put in. Yes, she replied. And made me look small by contrast. Even the Earl of Dorincourt's big dog did that. Did you get a crick in your neck from looking up at them at rehearsals? No, but they got my nerve one day after the picture was well started. I'd been too busy to think about it before, and had helped Mr. Green and Brother Jack with the direction, just as I have always done. But that morning, when I walked into my grandfather's banquet hall and found myself surrounded by his solemn-faced servants, I felt like Jack the Giant Killer in the Giant's Castle. What did you do? Look around for the hen that laid the golden eggs? The girl who played the boy, who made the combination of curls, lace collar, and silk sash popular for young gentlemen of 8, and thereby filled with anguish the souls of many snub-nosed, freckle-faced youngsters whose fond mammas were determined to make little Lord Fauntleroys out of their own little darlings in spite of any bodily handicap, shook her head. No, but it struck me for the first time that they must be secretly amused at being ordered about by such a physically inferior person as myself. For the moment, the thought got my nerve, and I had to pull myself together before I could steady my voice and tell Jack and Mr. Green what I thought should be done to improve the scene. It was all very serious to me, but of course I only got laughed at when I told Jack and Douglas how I felt. You will pardon me, then, if I indulge in a grin at your expense myself? Oh, yes. Everyone laughs at me when they hear the story. There was another interruption by telephone, and Sister Mary was immediately deep in a discussion over the screen rights of a stage success for Brother Jack. Mr. Fairbanks breezed in as his wife was hanging up the receiver, and I decided that I had come to the place marked exit for me. "I'm afraid you haven't found me a very clever talker," said Mary Pickford, as she gave me her hand. "Everything you have said and done has interested me immensely," I replied. Unexpected revelation of character is always engrossing, and it was evident that Mary Pickford has plenty of character of the most unexpected type. End of chapter 15. Recording by L. D. Hamilton.
Chapter 16 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. reading by Matt Perard. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 16. Gloria Swanson. Gloria Swanson's greatest thrill came to her in the Lion's Bride scene in Male and Female. It didn't require much penetration to sense a good story about the lady and the lion. And we plunged right into the subject the moment Gloria Swanson and I were seated. The first time I met Miss Swanson, she was one of the guests of honor at Dr. Reisenfeld's Rivoli Theater office tea the Sunday afternoon, Male and Female, opened in New York. Thomas Mann was another distinguished guest. There were no end of complimentary things said to the two leading actors in the picture by the other guests, all of whom had come upstairs from looking at the Barry play, but no one failed to refer to the scene Miss Swanson has with the lions. The members of the supposedly more timid sex who were present gave little shudders of fear and asked in almost breathless admiration, "How could you do it, Miss Swanson? Were you dreadfully frightened?" And then, in most cases, went on asking other questions without waiting for a reply to the first two. Everyone who has seen Male and Female will recall the Babylonian episode and the Christian slave's terrible death. A desire to know one's sensations when lying helpless on the floor of a lion pit and held down by the paws of a full-grown king of beasts prompted my request for an interview, and I found that Miss Swanson's recollection of all the details of this adventurous page in her moving picture experience was nothing short of acute. How did you feel when you were told you were to endanger both your life and your insurance policy at one fell swoop? Was my first question. The lady smiled cheerfully, but not at my attempt to be facetious. "I was the happiest girl around the studio," was her unexpected reply. "You see," she explained, "there was something very curious in such an incident falling to me. As a child, I had always been fascinated by the picture, The Lion's Bride. It made a lasting impression on my imagination from the first, and that I was to act the part of the Christian slave seemed like a decree of fate. Any thought of the danger I might run in my picture work never troubled me in the least. I had never been able to conquer my fear of the water when trying to learn to swim. I would put on a becoming bath suit and sit on the edge of the pool, but when the swimming teacher tried to get me into the water, I just wouldn't go. So, of course, I never learned. But when I was given my first serious part in a picture, and was told I must jump off a dock after nightfall and strike out, I didn't stop to tell the director I couldn't swim, but hopped in. I remember that picture. You swam all right. I knew I had to or give up the part, so I managed to keep myself afloat and save my contract." Gloria Swanson is a quiet, self-contained young woman under ordinary circumstances, but she has the true artistic temperament, and there is a smoldering fire in her dark eyes that would tell a director he need never fear her failing to carry through a scene, no matter how dangerous. There was no hint at boasting in her tone as she complied with my request to describe her own sensations while acting the Christian slave. It had been a wonderful event to her, not on account of the danger, but because the tragic episode made such a strong appeal to her dramatic instinct, and for this reason she was able to put the demands of her art before her natural fear of the wild beasts in the pit and act the part of the slave girl who desires a king, even when her own life is really in danger. Every precaution was taken to safeguard her, but Gloria Swanson had never before had any experience with lions, wild or tame, and she had been told that it is usually the tame ones that kill their keepers.
While the Babylonian scenes were being filmed, she was forced to come in close contact with both sorts of animals, not once, but several times. Under such circumstances, the actress might have been forgiven if it had taken no little urging to get her to complete her part of the episode, but she never held back for an instant. Thomas Mann bears witness to this. "She's the pluckiest little woman I ever knew," he declared when questioned about the matter. "The lions were in anything but a pleasant frame of mind all the time we were making those scenes. The picture shows that. But Miss Swanson never had to be told twice what to do. The lion pit is wide and deep, and I thought I was perfectly safe when I stood at the side of it, until ordered away by Mr. DeMille. My explanation that I wanted to watch the taking of the scene didn't do any good. I was again told to go away from there, and I went. A few minutes later, one of the lions felt the same about the pit, and he went away also. He suddenly stopped lashing his tail, cocked his eye at the wall, sailed into the air, and landed within 3 feet of where I had been standing. The keepers drove him back again, and I am still thankful that when a director is forced to tell me anything twice, I have sense enough to obey. I had repeated to Miss Swanson what her fellow player had said about her. She smiled, then looked serious. I am not the only one whose life was in danger while male and female was being produced, she explained. The shipwreck scene nearly proved fatal to Mr. Meehan. The yacht turned over so quickly that he got caught in the sail and was carried under the water. He stayed down so long, struggling to free himself, that we all thought he was drowned, and every one was badly scared until he managed to get clear of the wreck. There is such a thing as carrying realism too far, even in making moving pictures, I put in, and then led the conversation back to the lions and the lion's bride, with the request, "Please describe how the animal scenes were taken." Miss Swanson thought intently for an instant. The most noticeable thing was the seriousness with which everyone went about his share of the work. Nothing was done in a hurry. Mr. DeMille and the keepers were always as near to me as possible and were ready for any emergency. There was always real danger. I have been told so, and I was conscious of it. That must have been why the part seemed so real to me.
And you were not? I mean, you didn't mind going over the scene several times?
No, really.
But the close-up with the big fellow. The lion's bride incident. How did you feel when you were lying on the stone floor and felt the brute's paws on your bare back? Weren't you?
It gave me the greatest thrill I have ever had in my life.
Don't you mean chill?
Gloria Swanson laughed and shook her head, and I believe her. End of chapter 16.
Chapter 17 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Greg Giordano. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 17. Norma Talmadge enlarges on the delicate flavor of roast dog and alligator steak. Dressed in a yellow kimono-like garment, Norma Talmadge was engaged in sorting out the contents of a red cedar chest when disturbed by a knock at the open door of her dressing room. She looked up and smiled a welcome as she tossed a purse made from an alligator's foot into a waste paper basket and then dropped some torn-up letter in after it. "I'm cleaning house," she explained. "This is the first day I've used this room, since we returned from California, and I'm getting rid of a lot of papers and things I don't want. How did you enjoy your trip to the coast? It was mostly hard work, but we never could have made the Indian scene for the heart of Wetona, one quarter as well in the east. So I'm glad we went. Is Wetona the first Indian girl you ever played? Yes, and I love the part. Nature has done much for Norma Talmadge in a physical way, and her instinct and training have all been in the right direction for the delineation of a round of characters, women aglow with life and keen susceptibility, that have a firm hold on public interest. But it is her ability to get inside of the part she is playing, to know and feel every emotion of the woman she assumes to be, that gives this rather retiring and youthful-appearing little actress so large and enthusiastic a following. A noticeable trait is the brilliancy of her countenance when the right chord is struck to awaken her interest, a gift of the gods that is beyond price to a dramatic artist. The cedar chest having been put in order, Norma Talmadge produced a thermos bottle of hot malted milk and a box of homemade sandwiches, and offered to share her lunch. Sitting Turk fashion on a leather-covered couch, she nibbled at her modest repast, and tried to recall an odd or amusing incident in connection with her work. After turning the matter over in her mind for a moment, she came to the conclusion that nothing of that nature ever had happened. The waste-paper basket still stood in the center of the dressing-room, and the discarded purse caught my eye. "Isn't there a story connected with this alligator's foot, Miss Talmadge?"
"No, except that whenever I look at it, I'm reminded of how I lost one of my pets."
"Tell me about it." "It happened when we were in Florida last winter. I had a pet alligator, and I grew very fond of him. And so did my dog. The two would play together. That is, the poodle would do the playing, and Peter, that was the alligator, would open one eye and then go to sleep while the poodle stood and barked and jumped as near to him as he dared. They had great fun together. But one night it turned quite cold, and when I came downstairs for breakfast, Peter was huddled up in the corner of his box and wouldn't move. He felt so cold and stiff that I thought he must be freezing to death. I picked him up and ran out into the kitchen. The cook was broiling a steak, so I put Peter into the lower part of the oven. I intended to leave him there only a few moments while I looked over my mail. There were a number of letters that morning, and when I went back into the kitchen and opened the oven door, something told me I had left Peter in there too long. He was a nice, quiet, well-behaved alligator, and his chum, the poodle, missed him terribly. Is baked alligator a regular item on a Florida menu? Peter's mistress shook her head doubtfully. "I have heard of alligator steaks," she replied, "but I guess I'm the first to bake an alligator whole." "Speaking of strange dishes, Miss Talmadge, I understand that the Indians on the reservation gave you a feast and made you a princess of the tribe when you went west to complete the heart of Wetona. Was there any roast dog on the bill of fare?" Once more the owner of the late lamented Peter shook her head. "No, but I was terribly afraid there would be. And before the feast was finished, I was positive of it. You see, I took Fluff, that's the poodle, with me, and the day before the feast he disappeared. We searched everywhere for him, but he couldn't be found. I offered a reward and everything, but it did no good. So I was feeling very unhappy when we went over to the chief's house for the feast. The ceremony of taking me into the tribe and making me a princess was novel and interesting, and I had quite forgotten the lost poodle when we sat down to the feast. It would have passed off splendidly if I hadn't overheard a bit of conversation between Sidney Franklin and Thomas Meehan. We were being served with a meat course when my director leaned over and whispered to my leading man, 'Say, Tom, I wonder if they are going to give us any roast dog.' 'Of course,' replied Mr. Meehan. 'That's why Miss Talmadge can't find her poodle.' They hadn't really. No. Fluff was found in the woods next morning almost starved, but I only pretended to eat during the rest of the meal. My appetite went on a vacation and refused to come back." End of chapter 17. Recording by Greg Giordano, Newport Richey, Florida.
Chapter 18 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Andrea Kotzer. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 18. Constance Talmadge and Sister Natalie introduce Maria, the haughty but useful understudy. This has been a hard winter for moving picture stars. I was told it first by Dorothy Dalton, then Corinne Griffith repeated the same important information, and last week, over at the Norma Talmadge studio, Sister Constance added her testimony to the subject. The word hard applies solely to the weather. Not that these three leading lights of the screen haven't plenty of warm clothing to shield them from the cold. The trouble is, or was before the snow came, that a scenario might call for a number of exterior scenes in which the heroine tumbles out of a canoe into a lake or is caught in a downpour of rain, and summer be 2 or 3 months to the rear when the time came to shoot those particular scenes. Moving pictures are made the year around, you know. Well, last fall the weather got right sharp about the time Constance Talmadge was told by director Sidney Franklin that they were going to Bear Lake for the exterior scenes in 2 weeks, and Miss Constance gave an involuntary shiver. While the severe-looking party in evening clothes, who was supposed to be her father in The Love Expert, walked with much dignity down the hotel corridor and into his own room where his playful daughter had bestowed the trusting old maid, and repeated the action until it was safely recorded on the faithful film, the star of the picture told me why she gave that one shiver, and why she shivered many times more while those exterior scenes were being taken, shivered so rapidly that nothing but an ultra-rapid camera could have caught the shivers. If you have seen 2 weeks, you will remember that Lillams, the lady from the chorus, goes for a midnight bath in the lake. I nodded and gave a shiver myself. There is a close-up, continued Miss Talmadge, of Lillam standing in the water with just her head and shoulders showing above a large rock. She is supposed to be startled, but not so frightened that her teeth are chattering and her knees knocking together. But that is what really happened. The scenario called for a balmy summer night, but last October was a bad month for them, so I stood behind that rock and registered what I felt, half frozen and ready to cry from the cold. It didn't show in the picture. That part was carefully left out. Mr. Franklin coaxed and jollied and begged me until I managed to control my real feelings long enough to register the proper expression, but it's hardly more than a flash. Please, he kept saying to me. It's a warm night and you're not cold, only startled. What did you say? Nothing. I was so cold I couldn't talk. Perhaps your thoughts covered the situation. I know they did. I thought things I should never dare to say. But the worst was to come. I had to dress behind some strips of canvas made into a three-sided dressing room without a roof, and I nearly perished all over again. We're going to Palm Beach for the exteriors in The Love Expert, thank goodness. The set in use was a double one, showing a hotel corridor and one of the rooms opening from it. While the corridor scene was being made, I glanced into the adjoining room and saw what I took to be an actress in the Talmadge company, standing behind a large armchair. Her back was to me, the bright lights on the next set dazzling my eyes so that I could not see her distinctly. Several property men were busy in the room, and I was startled a moment later by hearing a cry of, "Look out!" I glanced into the set just in time to see one of the men back into the lady and knock her down. In an instant, they all turned and looked at the prostrate figure on the floor. "Well, why don't you pick her up?" demanded the chap who had given the cry of warning. "Ah, pick her up yourself. I'm too busy," was the surly reply. Astonished at such brutality, I turned to Miss Talmadge. She also had seen the accident, but made no effort to interfere. "Shall I began. "Pick her up?" replied Miss Talmadge. "If you want to. It's only my understudy." By this time, one of the men, more humane than his fellows, had stooped down and assisted the lady to her feet. "Understudy?" I repeated. "I didn't know that movie actresses ever had understudies." "Oh, yes. I find her very useful." "In what way?" "Natalie will introduce you. Mr. Emerson is ready for my next scene. Natalie, take Mr. Weitzel over and introduce him to Maria." And Sister Constance bestowed that famous one-eyed smile upon me and joined her director down the corridor. Miss Natalie Talmadge, who was standing near, led the way into the adjoining room, and I was duly presented to the understudy.
Not being an adept at painting pen portraits of beautiful women, I must refer the reader to the picture on page 112 for an adequate idea of the lady's personal charms. Miss Constance was gracious enough to have herself photographed with her understudy, but this should not make it at all difficult to identify Maria. Finding that the understudy was not inclined to talk about herself, I applied to Miss Natalie for information as to Maria's duties. The smallest of the Talmadge girls is a demure little woman, but she enjoyed her share in her sister's joke. Maria was Sidney Franklin's suggestion. He said that she would keep quiet while the lights were being adjusted, and Constance won't. She hates to stand still, was Miss Natalie's explanation. So Maria really earns her salary? Yes, indeed. She saves Constance a great deal of fatigue and gives her more time to answer telephone calls. Does your sister have many? About a dozen a day, but they're mostly from the same person. Excuse me, there's the phone ringing now. I must answer it for her. And, smiling meaningly, the demure Miss Natalie hurried off to the star dressing room, which, at the Norma Talmadge studio, consists of a four-room apartment complete in every detail and most tastefully furnished. But that apartment is another story. Here is a pleasant bit of gossip. Constance Talmadge is delightfully friendly and easy to approach. She had been told that I was to drop into the studio for a chat, and so she looked over and smiled when the director stopped the rehearsal for a moment and she saw me standing at one side of the set. We had never met before, but I had no trouble in recognizing her, of course, and she knew me instantly. Not, however, by the strawberry mark upon my left arm, because I haven't any, but for the reason that I was accompanied by the member of the studio publicity staff whose duty, and I trust pleasure it is, to introduce meek and lowly scribes to the Talmadge constellation of stars. End of chapter 18. Recording by Andrea Kotzer.
Chapter 19 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Kevin Davidson. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Pearl White. Pearl White, heroine of 1,000 movie stunts, snatches Tony the Wop from honest-to-goodness peril. The director had just finished rehearsing an interior scene and was about to give the signals light, action, camera, when Pearl White, leaning forward in a listening attitude in place of gazing up at the big police captain, called out, "Hold it a minute," and disappeared around the corner of the set. From the fire escape outside the studio came the sound of one who was being hard-pressed by the enemy. It was also evident that the imperiled person was defending himself valiantly, with his tongue at least, in hurling a bewildering mixture of English and Italian malediction and defiance in the very teeth of his tormentors. Before a properly constructed rescue squad could be organized by the studio force, or the five stalwart police officers who were rehearsing with the star in the blue tailor-made suit could draw their clubs and rush to the rescue, Pearl White was back in the room, accompanied by a grimy little chap who grinned with pride and pleasure. "The gang was trying to beat up Tony again," she explained. Everyone showed sympathy and smiled encouragingly at the small son of Italy. He was quickly installed on the top of a radiator at the side of the room by his rescuer and bidden to keep quiet for a few minutes. I thought this was my opportunity to introduce myself to Pearl White. She was agreeable about an interview after the scene was finished. "While you are waiting," she suggested, "you might interview Tony. He's been around the studio for 3 days now, and lots of people learn all about the moving picture business in less time than that." In another moment the actress was in the center of the set, surrounded by the five policemen, and the two cameras were busy with their share of the work. Tony the Wop did not look very promising, but the story of his rescue from the gang suggested thrills and swift action. Both were Pearl White's specialties, and Tony's tale might throw a strong sidelight on an unknown phase of her character. A glance at the small boy on the radiator brought a friendly grin. "Why were the gang trying to beat you up, Tony?"
"They don't like, 'cause I know her."
"Why not?"
dey don't like, 'cause I goes in the machine.
Do you mean that you go in the auto with Miss White when she is making a picture?
Yep, I been two times.
The boy's grin was now one of sheer delight.
What do you do? Set in the auto and watch that for her.
That was a small makeup box on the other end of the radiator. She gives me money, 5 cents at a time.
Where did Miss White see you first?
In a fight. Two fellers had me down and was a-punching me when she came by in the auto. She jumped out and pulled them off and give me a nickel, and I'm going to get another. Here she comes now.
Tony proved correct in his forecast. The first thing Pearl White did when she reached her youthful admirer was to open her purse and take out a coin.
"Here's a quarter, Tony. Get yourself 5 cents worth of candy and bring me back the change."
Tony took the money and hurried away.
"His father has gone back to Italy and is fighting for his country," the actress explained. "The family haven't any too much to live on. Now about this interview, is it going to cost me money?"
"Not a penny.
That suits me.
I've always heard you were a good businesswoman, Miss White."
"Not always. Most of the time, perhaps. What do you want me to tell you?"
"About some of your interesting happenings since you've been in moving pictures."
"Can't do it."
"Why not?"
"They're all in my book, My Struggle for Fame. It's the story of my life. Tells how I started when I was 11 as an actress playing Eva in Uncle Tom's Cabin, then joined a circus, got hurt, had to go to work as a nurse girl after I got out of the hospital, got back on the stage, and finally landed in the pictures. Most of the interviews tell about the movie stars after they've got to the top and have autos and fine homes and everything. My book tells about the way I had to work before I got into pictures." As she finished speaking, Tony walked up to her and held out the quarter.
"Where's your candy?" demanded the actress.
"Money's no good."
The boy drew a deep breath.
"That's why I gave it to you. Take a long look at it, and be careful you don't take any more phony money after this. Hand it back now, and I'll give you a nickel."
As Tony's short legs carried him and his expansive grin rapidly to the door, his fairy godmother walked over to the makeup box on the radiator, touched up her lips with a lipstick, and seemed to forget all about the incident. Pearl White is evidently used to doing little things, such as making a child happy. End of chapter 19. Recording by Kevin Davidson. www.blogordie.com.
Chapter 20 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Kevin Davidson. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Clara Kimball Young. Clara Kimball Young recalls the delights of leopard skin lingerie, stone bruises, and snakes. Henceforth and forever, cave women, belles of the jungle, and all classes of lovely ladies who wear leopard skin lingerie and neglect to patronize a Fifth Avenue bootmaker are banished from the repertory of Clara Kimball Young. The star of The Savage Woman has said it, and said it so emphatically that there is not the slightest reason to believe she will ever change her mind until the latest styles in Parisian footwear are de rigueur on the burning sands of Central Africa and fashion taboos bare feet in that section. Seated at a large flat-topped mahogany desk in the center of the Clara Kimball Young Picture Company office, and dressed in a French horizon blue suit of military cut and a chic turban to match, the lady of the luminous eyes hung up the telephone after a series of explicit injunctions as to the making of several costumes needed in her next picture, and answered an inquiry about her latest release with the declaration, "No more barefoot parts for mine."
"You didn't enjoy this getting near to nature experience, then, Miss Young?"
"Quite the contrary."
"I had thought it would be good fun to discard the conventional articles of civilized attire for a rug kimono and roam the desert sands or climb nimbly from limb to limb of the banyan tree, clad in innocence and the glad smile of the humorist. I know better now. Palm Canyon, with the mercury registering 114 degrees and no shade, is no place to run about barefooted and pretend you were born to the sport."
"That was the impression you gave in the picture."
"It's kind of you to say so, but if I succeeded in disguising my real feelings, it was one of the most difficult pieces of acting I've ever done in my life. You remember this scene?"
Miss Young pointed to a large photograph standing against the wall, showing her as the heroine of The Savage Woman. "You look very happy and much at your ease."
"I was never so uncomfortable in my life. The heat was terrible. I waded through a brook in the hopes it would cool me off a little, and the water was almost hot. Then I stepped on a stone and bruised my foot. I wanted to sit down on the sand and examine the bruise, but I didn't. I stood up for the same reason the boy stood on the burning deck. It was too hot to sit down. Then the snakes. The place is full of rattlers."
"Did you step on any?"
"No, I'm not afraid of snakes, but I prefer to have my boots on when we meet."
"The place where the African scenes were made is called Palm Canyon, you say?"
"Yes, it is full of palm trees, and no one knows how they got there. We lost a number of monkeys and parrots while the scenes were being taken. One of these days the palm trees will be full of monkeys and parrots."
"And no one will know how they got there."
The interviewee agreed, but shifted the location from California to Washington, and continued her remarks on snakes. "Speaking of snakes, there was one member of the tribe that made me register sudden and honest-to-goodness surprise and terror. It was at Seattle. Being in a dry state and in a state of dryness, I entered a restaurant with a party of friends after one of my speeches during my recruiting tour through the Northwest, and ordered a lemonade. While I was sipping it, I happened to glance at a small palm near my elbow, and there was a little green snake hanging over the side of the pot."
"Was this after your fourth or your fifth lemonade?"
"It was during my first."
"They must make them strong in Seattle. What did you do after registering fright?"
"Followed the regular business of the scene by demanding of the entire party if they all saw the same thing I did. Fortunately for my peace of mind and the reputation of the great state of Washington for the enforcement of its liquor laws, they did. But what is the use of having liquor laws if they are unable to keep the snakes away?"
Which profound moral issue, being beyond me to answer, I changed the subject. "How do you like the idea of taking down the barrier between artist and the public, Miss Young, and coming in close contact with the men and women who have learned to know and admire you on the screen?" I asked.
"You mean by making speeches in public? I think it is an excellent thing from every point of view," replied Miss Young. "The artist learns things that way. Quite a change, isn't it, from the Augustan Daly law? His actors, you know, were not allowed to walk on Broadway. If they wished to pass along that famous thoroughfare, they were obliged to take a cab. That may have been good theatrical law in the old days. Moving picture stars can profit more by letting their admirers see them in the flesh and hear their voices. Besides, as I said before, we learn things from them. I'm a believer in the old hug-and-kiss finish, and so is the public."
"How did you find that out?"
"By asking my audiences whenever I got the chance."
End of chapter 20. Recording by Kevin Davidson, www.bloggerdie.com.
Chapter 21 of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Greg Giordano. Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel. Chapter 21. The Message of the Bluebird. First printed April 27, 1918. "These are actors, as I foretold you, were all spirits, and are melted into air, into thin air, and, like the baseless fabric of this vision, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, yea, all which it inherits, shall dissolve, and, like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a wreck behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a sleep. It will be recalled that Peter Pan never grew up. It is quite as reasonable to predict that the bluebird will never grow old. One of these days Peter will find his way onto the screen, and what an enchanting young hero he will make. And what wonderful views of the Never-Never Land we shall behold. In the meantime, we have the bluebird.
Maeterlinck's fairy story has many things in common with Barrie's quaint conceit that so truthfully depicts the heart of childhood. First, both tales were written by poets, and that is greatly in their favor. It means that beautiful thoughts are to be found in them, that they contain no false thing. Both show the souls of a child's good influences, the familiar everyday companions that shape his life, and the child is father to the man. In their wisdom, Maeterlinck and Barrie endow dumb animals with human qualities. We all remember the dog nurse in Peter Pan, and the four-footed protector of the children in the Bluebird. What wise counsel this faithful animal gives his boy and girlfriends, once he is able to use the language of two-footed folk. To understand such things, and to have it in one's power to make the world understand them, is to add immeasurably to the sum of human happiness. And happiness is the inspiration to be drawn from the Bluebird. And at this time, when the reality of the great conflict is burning itself deeper and deeper into mind and heart, we need to be assured of the beauties of life, to have recalled a picture of what the future holds for our children, if they are permitted to seek for happiness along the paths of peace, and to learn that selfishness creates every form of misery in the world. The Bluebird was widely and favorably known in this country before its appearance on the screen. Originally, the poem was read and enjoyed in printed form by the select few who had the time and the training to keep pace with the best in literature. Its production at the new theater in Central Park West, when that costly but ill-starred temple of the drama was offering its mental uplift to the public, and its subsequent successful tour of the country, brought the Maeterlinck's fairy tale to the notice of a large number of men, women, and children who took keen enjoyment in the story and the artistic manner in which it was shown on the stage. It was a foregone conclusion that the Bluebird would find its way to the screen. The subject matter, the scope and variety of its scenic possibilities, the spectacular effects permitted by its weird and fanciful incidents, the charm that the camera could throw over everything, ensured its eventual appearance in the moving picture theater. The Bluebird carries a message in its beak. This message is so simple, it is easily grasped by the mind of a child. He will miss the deeper significance of some of the scenes, but the most important lesson will never elude his mental vision. The palace of luxuries and the cavern of miseries may fascinate or awe the little fellow without leaving a clear impression of their meaning, and the graveyard at midnight may fail of a like purpose. But the cathedral of happiness in the Azure Palace, where the unborn children wait, will fill him with delighted comprehension, and he will understand the beautiful symbolism of Father Time starting his little charges on the voyage of life, and the joy of the waiting mothers. When he has finished with title and mitre, the journey after the bird of happiness, he will have learned that the lesson taught his companions encompasses a great truth. Happiness need not be sought after. It comes of its own free will to those who try to make others happy. End of chapter 21. Recording by Greg Giordano, Newport Richie, Florida. End of Intimate Talks with Movie Stars by Edward Weitzel.